Buenos días, damas y caballeros. Yo soy su auxiliar de vuelo, Abner Bonilla de Boston. Su piloto de hoy es el Capitán Jeff. Su copiloto es Ricardo de Miami. Y el doctor para el vuelo es la doctora Stephanie. Por favor, levantar sus mesillas. Abrocharse sus cinturones. Subir sus asientos. Usted está escuchando el piloto de las aerolíneas y su vista de la cabina. Aquí está su locutor, el Capitán Jeff.
Piloto de aerolínea, episodio 174.
Hello, you're listening to the Airline Pilot Guy Show, the view from my side of the cockpit door. I'm Captain Jeff, your host, broadcasting live from Studio 1A in the APG headquarters building in an Atlanta suburb. In today's episode, an express jet flight diverts to an inappropriate airport, hail, pummels, a Delta 747, a teen cranks up a medevac helicopter at an air show, and a C-130 crashes in Indonesia. So get all settled in, tray tables and seat backs in their upright and locked positions, electronic devices powered on. Flight 174 is ready for pushback. I'm laughing a little bit because I guess the spelling correction, I put teen cranks up a medevac, and apparently spelling on the Apple decided to turn it into medieval helicopter.
I don't think how does one of those work?
I don't know if they had medieval helicopters.
I'm picturing like a Leonardo da Vinci-esque.
That's exactly what it is.
Like that screw, you know?
Oh,
sorry,
man.
I didn't need to crack up there.
Yeah,
too,
it was not good. Yeah. It was not appropriate for me to be laughing at that point because then the very next line was the C-130 crash in Indonesia. I am sorry out there, folks, but that's just the way it goes at the APG. Hello, and you can hear those other folks joining me, my co-hosts in the background. We have Miss Stephanie in Charlotte. Hello.
Hola, ¿cómo estás? Oh, I thought we were doing the episode in Spanish.
Well, it won't go very far if we have to do it in Spanish because I don't know a lot of Spanish. And, of course, a man that does is Rick, Miami Rick.
Buenas tardes, APGers. Un gusto tenerlos con nosotros una vez más.
Oh, boy.
I can go all day.
Yeah, I know you can because, well, remind people, you are a native Ecuadorian?
I am a native Ecuadorian from Quito up in the mountains.
Yeah.
I can go all day.
Wow. And again, remind us, it was like 13 years old when you moved to...
Yeah, moved to the States when I was about 13. Yeah. So been here for, you know, most of my life, but my early teens and my childhood was spent between, Ecuador and Scotland before that. We have family out there, so...
Scotland. Oh, neat. All right. Well, Thank you for joining me, everybody. And I just got back from a four-day trip. Well, things have been very, very busy. First, so I'd like to start off by saying thank you, everyone out there listening, especially those of you who have listened for quite some time and have known that my mother has been sick for the last several years. Actually, she suffered Parkinson's for at least 10 years, and then last couple of years she's been in an assisted living facility, and I go out try to get out there about every month to visit, and she just passed away on the 15th of last month, June. And so many of you, the outpouring of condolences and prayers and thoughts and all of that is just really, really overwhelming. Thank you, everyone who has expressed that to me, and it's really appreciated. I really do appreciate that. And things have been kind of, you know, tough for me this month. The beginning of the month before my mom passed away was the conference that I was kind of in charge of coordinating, and that was, you know, busyness enough for me and stress enough. But then my mom passing away, it's just crazy. I'm glad that June is over with. In the midst of all this, of course, you know, we had I mentioned that I got some coffee mugs and pint glasses printed. Many of you have expressed a desire to receive one or more of those items, and I still have all of you and your requests, and I'm going to do my best to make good on sending those and, you know, all that kind of stuff. So just hang in there. I'll get to it eventually. But this past weekend was my mom's funeral on Saturday, and it was crazy. We took the first flight out of Atlanta in the morning. We almost didn't make the flight, but we did. We got out there, and then it was craziness getting out there, renting the car, changing quickly, getting to the funeral, going to the graveside service, and then the next morning we had to get up at 2:30 in the morning to catch a 5:25 flight because I had to return the rental car and everything else. And we all made it on that one, thank God, and got back to Atlanta in the afternoon, and then all went to Mass at 5 o'clock, and then the next day I'm off on a 4-day trip again. So I probably should have just tried to drop the trip, but I went ahead and flew it anyway, and just got back from that. So it's been nonstop for me for quite some time. So I'm ready to just take a really, really deep breath. And but again, I'm emboldened, and I'm trying to think of what the right word is. But it's just so nice to know that all of you out there listening, watching the show are my friends, and that you care so much about me, and we care about each other so much. So I just wanted to say that I do appreciate all of it. And so hopefully everything will go back to normal very soon. There we go.
Well, I was going to say, nothing like a holiday weekend to kind of reset and recharge and refresh. So
absolutely. I'm supposed to go back out again on another trip on Monday through Thursday. But the cool thing is, you know, the 4th of July is our Independence Day in the United States. That's a big day, a big holiday in the United States. But my oldest daughter was born on that day in 1987. And so that is not Independence Day in my family. It's Alyssa's birthday. Ooh. So I'll be home for that. And I am looking forward to celebrating with the family. Everybody is home now. Chris, my son at the University of Central Florida, is finished with his summer semester work, and he's home. And the whole gang is here, so it's going to be a lot of fun. And I'm looking forward to spending time with family and just kicking back and letting my brain just, you know, rest. So, but I really am glad that Miami Rick and Dr. Steph are here helping me with this show, because it makes it easier for me. And it's a lot more fun that way, too, because we can chew our gum and drink beer.
Yeah, we're happy to be here. Actually, you know, it's interesting because I had a talk with Miami Mike. Actually, I called him up earlier in the week.
Yeah.
Actually, I had to have him fly down to the Miami branch office of APG's Miami branch office. So I brought him upstairs to the office and sat him down. I told him, dude, and this gum chewing thing, you know, it can't happen. And he assured me that from now on he's gonna, you know, only chew sugar free soundless gum. But the interesting part, and kind of the ironic part here to this whole gum chewing situation, is that the Airline Pilot Guy episode 174 is brought to you by Miami Mike's ear piercing sugar free peppermint gum. So that's when you need your fresh breath to make a statement. So I don't know. I'm kind of but we talked about it. You know, he said he wouldn't do it again. So we can put that one to rest.
That's very rude when you're chewing something. Right.
I don't know. Okay. I don't know about him.
All right.
Yeah.
Okay. Actually, I'm chewing taffy, banana taffy. That was one of my Father's Day gifts.
Yeah. Actually, he's gonna change from gum to beef jerky.
Oh. Well, that will be better. Or not.
He's maybe saying that it might be better. So we, I'm actually, he's actually working on a sponsorship from them, I guess.
Yeah. Well, you know what I think about all that?
What's that?
It's so sad. It's a sad, sad situation. Yeah.
We can fix that with the quickness. Hang on, listen to this.
Mm.
Ooh.
I
sounds
like
delicious.
It.
That's what she said.
That is what she said. I just heard her. Okay.
Yeah, me too. That's what I'm saying.
That's what she said.
Okay, let's move on. Oh, before we move on to the news, of course, we have to do this. The Java Jive. That was not the thing I was supposed to.
Johnny, how much smoke up?
No thanks.
Oh boy, this thing. Well, if anybody's ever heard my other show that I do, Catholic Weekend, we talk about train wrecks, and this was a train wreck already. Airline pilot got a train wreck. I should probably find my train whistle, but I don't see it anywhere, so I can't blow my train whistle. Oh well. Anyway, the coffee fund is, you know, let me apologize to anybody. I'm going to turn that off for a second. I would like to offer my sincere apologies to anybody who is watching or listening to this show for the very first time. This was probably recommended to you by some other great aviation podcast out there, and they probably talked about what a great show this is, and you're thinking to yourself, this is a really bad show, and I apologize for that. We're going to try to do better, so we're going to start like this. Now it's time for the coffee fund. My co-hosts are not saying anything.
Johnny, how much more cost?
No thanks.
Pondering on this word.
I was going to say we're all professionals here. It's...
Well, not really. Well, you're a professional doctor, and I'm a professional pilot. Miami Rick and I are professional pilots, but... we are not professional broadcasters. So the Coffee Fund is your way to help support the Airline Pilot Guy show. And you're thinking, well, what is involved? I mean, why do you need help with that? Well, it's free to you to listen to, but it does have some costs associated with it. Website hosting. We have media hosting costs. A lot of other costs associated with the show. And this is just your way to help out if you so desire. And you have the resources to do so. If you're somebody who is a college student or somebody who is just taking flying lessons and that kind of thing, we don't want you to send us any money for the coffee fund because you need that money to, you know, do whatever you're doing to make yourself into a pilot. So, but if you're somebody who is, you know, I should probably just start the whole show over. If you're somebody who has the financial resources to contribute something to the coffee fund, you can find out more information about it by going over to airlinepilotguy.com/coffee. So, since the last show, Larry James, Mike Rogers, and Steve Trumbull used the Coffee Fund Classic method, and we have a couple new patrons at patreon.com, and we have Adam Asmar and Daniel King. If you want to find out the different ways that you can contribute via the Coffee Fund, head over to airlinepilotguy.com/coffee. And thank you to one and all who have contributed in the past. And let's move on, shall we, to the news. Let's start with this. It was an express jet flight heading to Dallas-Fort Worth. And apparently there was some weather in the Dallas-Fort Worth area. Big surprise this time of year. And they started running low on fuel. And they diverted to an airport nearby, just to the east-northeast of the Dallas-Fort Worth International Airport, Majors Airport, in Greenville, Texas. And, well, the problem with going to Majors Airport in Greenville, Texas, which I've never heard of, is that it's not really set up to support, you know, scheduled airline service. And so they got there, and it turns out that there was no fire department, no staff at the airport, no one at the airport when they landed. And they did find somebody with a fuel truck, but the people that operate the fuel truck really didn't know how to put fuel in the airplane. And so they sat there for quite some time waiting for some folks from the airline to drive from Dallas-Fort Worth over to this airport to fuel the airplane. And basically they finally got to the Dallas-Fort Worth airport about 11 o'clock that night. It was an Embraer 170 regional jet that made the diversion. And we talked about another instance of, you know, a flight diverting to an airport that didn't seem like it was the best place to divert. And we were discussing this before we started the recording that, you know, it's important when your dispatcher, if you're flying for a scheduled airline, when your dispatcher puts designates an alternate on your flight plan, you should probably pay attention to what airport your dispatcher is declaring for your alternate and maybe do a little bit of, you know, thinking about it and seeing whether or not this airport is definitely one that you should consider, or maybe question it and have a discussion with your dispatcher and say, you know what, maybe we should make, now, you know, of course, you know, if you do one that's very, very close to your destination, then you don't have to have as much fuel on board to take care of that, you know, legal requirement. But that's not always the best way to handle the situation. What do you think about that, Rick?
Yeah, I do. And before I start talking, I want to apologize if you guys can hear some Skyping. I've been having some connectivity issues here. Do you hear me okay?
Yeah, sound fine.
Sounds good.
Okay, cool. All right. So, as you guys and gals know, there's certain requirements to dispatching a commercial aircraft. One of them is having a suitable alternate airport. But you can't, like Captain Jeff just said, you can't just divert to any airport because there are certain things that you have to keep in mind. Facilities-wise, when you get to that airport, the kind of maintenance that you might have available there, the fuel that you might have available, because you'd be surprised. You fly to some airports, you may not even have Jet A fuel. You know, so basically, if there's no Jet A fuel, you can't leave, or you have to truck the fuel in. And a very important part of considering an airport as a suitable airport for a diversion is the emergency and firefighting equipment that that airport might have. I was talking to Captain Jeff and Dr. Steph before we started recording, and I was commenting how at my airline, on the dispatch NOTAMs, we actually get all the airports that are listed as our alternates, and there's a scale between 1 to 10, just arbitrary number, you know, 1 to 10, 1 being not suitable, 10 being it's got everything. And for us to be able to consider that airport as a destination, the firefighting equipment and the emergency equipment and the facilities at the airport, they have to be ranked at least an 8. And for us to be able to have that as an alternate airport, it has to be ranked at least a 7. We can't take any less than a 7. So my point here is, you can't just, you know, just divert to any airport because it's there. You have to take into account many, many things.
Yes, you do. And but apparently, you know, this worked out eventually. But, you know, you have like desirable destination alternates. And then if you're in a situation where you're in an emergency situation, you know, like at emergency fuel levels, then you go wherever you can get the airplane on the ground. But, yeah, excuse me. Wow.
Well, Captain Jeff deals with that. I want to also point out that we as airline pilots, we're not qualified to actually fuel the airplane. There's a separate panel underneath the wing where you set the desired fuel load that's going to go to each tank, and there's an actual sequence that the tanks are filled in. So it's not like, you know, you go to the gas station, you know, you put the hose in the fuel receptacle and just slot your credit card in and out and just, you know, put fuel in. There's a sequence that you have to keep the fuel balanced. You have to deal with what's called specific gravity, because you have to remember that fuel is basically dealt in. It's fueled in volume, but then the fuel quantity indicating system on aircraft has to translate that into weight. So there's calculations involved that we're not, we know how to do them, but we're not certified to actually go on the book and set and sign the book off saying that we fueled the aircraft in accordance to maintenance manual, whatever, whatever, because we're not qualified or certified to do it. So we actually need maintenance personnel to do that for us, which is why you need to divert to an airport that has that maintenance for personnel readily available for us to be able to continue the flight on to our main destination once we're done at our alternate airport.
Yeah, just makes sense.
And I was going to chime in. While you guys were talking, I looked up Majors Airport, and there is an FBO there. It's Greenville Aviation. It says they do have Jet A and 100 low lead fuel. Service is available, courtesy cars and vans, limo service, aircraft maintenance, avionics maintenance, aircraft parking, pilot supplies, flight instruction, rental cars, and catering. But it sounds basically like a small GA airport.
Apparently when they got there, it was after hours.
8 a.m. to 5 p.m. daily.
Ah, and they arrived at Majors Airport at 7:21.
There you go.
After everybody left for the day. Oh, well. Okay.
Yeah, it was interesting.
Yeah. Well, speaking of interesting, there was a Delta 747 that was going from Detroit, I think, to or Minneapolis. Where did they start? I forget now. But they were heading over to Seoul, Korea. Oh, Detroit. Actually, it was the flight was on June 16th from Detroit to Seoul. And somewhere over China, they experienced a little bit of rough weather. They flew into a hail storm and did a lot of damage to the airplane. And I'm looking at the pictures right now. The radome is destroyed. The leading edges of the wing have been... Looks like somebody took a ball peen hammer and just several ball peen hammers and just hammered the heck out of the leading edges of the airplane. The engine cowlings, the tail of the airplane, lots and lots of damage. In fact, they're saying that they're probably going to just total the airplane and scrap it. That's how much damage is on the airplane. And now you're thinking, well, how did they get themselves into this situation? And apparently, I've never flown in China myself, but I guess the airspace is very restricted. And when you have filed a certain route, they don't let you deviate very much from that route. It's like 5 to 10 miles of the center line of the route. And as we all know, well, not all of us, but any of us who have flown commercial airline flights know that 5 to 10 miles may not be near enough of a off-course deviation to avoid severe weather. And so it's either go on your routing or hold or orbit, as they say in China, apparently. And this flight continued, and they experienced some pretty nasty hail and severe turbulence. And no one was injured, thankfully. And they made it to the destination. But the airplane is kind of torn up, and so much so that they're thinking that they're probably just going to scrap the thing, which is kind of sad. But, you know, I think Delta was already kind of looking at retiring their entire 747 fleet over the next few years.
It says in the article, Delta is phasing out its 747 fleet by 2017.
There you go. So, yeah, that's only a couple of years from now, so... I guess it's not as bad as it could be. You know, if it was something that they were thinking about using for many, many more years, it would have been a much more significant thing. But, I can't imagine being on that airplane going through a hailstorm. I just, I'm sure that it was very nerve-wracking, and I bet the crew thought that that was it.
that was right through that ITZ, huh?
Well, actually, it was in, I don't know, I think it was pretty far north of the ITZ.
Well, was it really?
Okay. Yeah, up in China.
Well, if it was going to Korea, that's pretty far north. But,
yeah, and they were even further north when they experienced this. I don't know. I've never been to that area of the world, so I'm not sure. But it was,
storm. I've never flown in China, but they're saying, I mean, what I've heard is from people that have actually flown there is that, you don't just, you know, deviate on your own over there because it can get a little, you know, dicey. And just like you said, many times, you know, I've had instances when I've had to deviate 150, 200 miles to get around a system, and there's really no way to get through it. So
yeah, And apparently, from what I don't know that much about the airspace in China because I've not flown there myself, but I understand that it's very much military controlled and very little room there for commercial aviation. And if you're operating a commercial aviation flight, especially from a different country, they expect you to pretty much track the route that you filed and not deviate from it. So anyway, not a good situation, but the good news is that they made it to the destination and nobody was injured and everybody is safe and sound. I don't know if you guys heard about this one, but just a little while ago, I don't know when it was, must have been over the weekend. That's usually when they have air shows. The Mankato Air Show had some airplanes out there on a static display, I guess. And they thought at first it was a six-year-old child that had climbed into the cockpit of a medevac helicopter and pushed the buttons to start the helicopter engine and rotor. And it turns out now the FAA is saying that they have determined that it was a 17-year-old who started the helicopter while on display over the weekend during an air show near Mankato, in Minnesota. The rotor blades of the Mayo Clinic medical emergency helicopter unexpectedly began whirring at the Minnesota Air Spectacular at the Mankato Regional Airport. The sudden blast of wind knocked over a large sun shield on the tarmac. Two people were hit and slightly injured. A worker at the show video recorded a portion of the brief time when the helicopter was roaring and said he saw a Mayo aviation employee remove a crying boy from the aircraft. So they estimated that boy was six years old. That's why they thought that the six-year-old was the one that was responsible for getting the airplane started or the engine started on the helicopter. But I'm thinking to myself, airplanes aren't like regular vehicles where you just, you have to have a key to start up the engine. Airplanes don't need keys, as far as I know. Maybe some of the business jets do.
Well, no, general aviation aircraft do.
Okay.
Oh, you mean like that Seinfeld episode?
Yeah, the Seinfeld episode. Which one were you talking about? The one
when he does this little stand-up comedy thing, and he sees the pilot run out of the flight deck because he says he forgot the keys at the nightstand of the hotel.
I've used that a few times myself when we're like delayed at the gate, and I'll go on the PA and I'll say, "Oh, ladies and gentlemen, this is kind of embarrassing. I thought the co-pilot had the key, and he thought I had the key, and well, we can't find the key." And that's why we're going to, but then I'll say, never mind. No, just kidding. We don't require a key on these kind of airplanes. But most commercial type aircraft don't require any kind of key to get them started. Of course, you have to know how to get the engine started. And that's not always an easy thing. But as long as you have, electricity and pneumatic air, that's usually the two things that are required, and then know which button to push or what tab to pull or whatever switch to activate, you can get it started. And apparently the 17-year-old knew which button to push.
Yeah. Right. Go ahead.
I'm sorry, and the correct sequence, because you don't only need to know what buttons to push and what tabs to pull and switches to actuate. You also need to know the correct sequence, because if you don't do it in the correct sequence, then nothing happens.
Yeah, I'm wondering if this guy must have had Microsoft Flight Simulator Medevac Helicopter Edition or something.
Probably, yeah. Possible. With the realistic Google Earth scenery. Yeah. Perhaps. I don't know.
No, I mean seriously. He had to know what he was doing to get the thing started, right?
Yeah. I think so. I don't know anything about medevac style helicopters, but for small single engine general aviation aircraft, you do actually have a key, and it turns just like the key in your car. I mean, you have to have things set up correctly with fuel flow usually and all of that, but it's not that difficult.
I mean, even in that case, you have to kind of have some idea.
Get to know a little bit
of what what knob to pull and what throttle to put up to a certain position, etc.
Right.
So, yeah. So I don't know. Kind of a weird situation. I'm glad that nobody was hurt in that situation. Well, seriously hurt. I guess the couple folks that got hit by that tent that was blown over got slightly injured. But And then, of course, we have this last thing in the news segment where many, many people were injured. Not only injured, they were killed. 12 crew and 110 passengers. A Lockheed C-130 Hercules, operated by the Indonesian Air Force's 32 Squadron, was destroyed when it crashed shortly after takeoff from an Air Force base in Indonesia. The aircraft took off at 11:48 local time, and shortly after takeoff, the crew radioed that they were returning to base. Apparently, the reports are that they lost one of the engines on takeoff, and because of a low rate of climb, the airplane reportedly impacted a 100-foot high antenna before it impacted buildings. So that's a sad situation over in Indonesia with a really nice airplane, C-130. So our thoughts and prayers go to the souls of the individuals that lost their lives and the families and friends as well.
Yep.
I don't know what else to say about that.
Absolutely.
All right. Are you guys ready to start tackling some of this feedback?
Yeah, go for it.
Okay.
Let's do it.
Captain, incoming message.
All right. Let's start with this, and this is sent to me by a couple of you, Mark Ross and Big Ron in the UK. And apparently, if you're listening to the show and you want to become an airline pilot, head over to India, because it apparently only takes 35 minutes of flight time to get your pilot's license.
So yeah. You're telling me I spent all that money where you could have done it in 35 minutes?
Apparently, yeah.
Yeah, I feel extraordinarily ripped off.
Yeah, well, we all do. Let's see. Anupam Verma has a certificate that shows he has flown an aircraft for 360 hours. He says he got it after sitting in the co-pilot seat for just 35 minutes. He's one of dozens of pilots in the country who obtained certificates showing inflated flying hours and ground training, according to court documents and interviews with pilots, regulators, and industry analysts. He's the son of a poor farmer. He was given 2.8 million rupee, which is still a large sum of money, $44,000 U.S., a subsidy by the Indian government to learn to fly a commercial jet. And then he is quoted as saying, what if I was flying and had an emergency? I wouldn't even know how or where to land. He said in an interview, we'd kill not only the passengers, but we might crash in a village and kill even more people.
That would be bad.
So the spotlight on aviation safety has swung from aircraft reliability to pilot reliability in the past few years after a series of disasters that were thought to be either deliberate actions of destruction or the result of inadequate training. So anyway, apparently people are padding their logbooks and not really, you know, getting the training that their logbooks reflect over there in India. And they, you know, they need a lot of people, qualified people, to fly airplanes over in India because they're really expanding rapidly.
Well, I mean, there's just a lot of people in India to begin with, but I can't imagine 35 minutes. What do you do with 35 minutes of flight time? That's not...
I mean, and you can tell that he's concerned about it. So, this is crazy. What do you mean? You know, I wouldn't know what to do. I don't know how to fly an airplane.
I mean, here in the United States, if you're going to do a basically like a discovery flight or an intro to fly lesson, usually that even lasts an hour. So, yeah. And you're not the one landing the plane at the end of that flight, even though you might have the controls and fly and do some basic stuff, but that's really no time at all.
No. And they said that when they were reviewing some of these records of pilots and their logged flying time, they said that hours were logged with aircraft not even in airworthy condition. One aircraft had no engines, but several hundred hours had been logged with no engines. Wow. That's amazing. talking about new technology. So, yeah, interesting article. Rick, are you with us still?
Yeah, I'm back. Well, the reason why you guys were Skyping a little bit, and the reason why is because I just realized that my sister's back, and she was watching a movie downstairs with the kids, and so I told her to please hold off on that activity until further notice.
That tends to use a lot of your bandwidth.
Yeah. So, well, it's back to the old school DVD player for a little bit.
Okay. Well, we'll try to get through this show quickly so that they can get
Netflix. It's good. Don't worry about it. We're good now.
All right. Good. Let's see. Private pilot Arno from Paris sent me a link to this beautiful video of you guys have heard of this Jetman guy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he's actually a pilot for Swiss Airlines, isn't he?
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, he's a 330 captain for Swiss Airlines.
Wow. Apparently, he likes to do some extracurricular flying with the little wing that he straps on himself and goes up there with four little jet engines and does all kinds of crazy things. Great video of him doing a show with another guy over Dubai, and you'll recognize some of the architectural landmarks and such from Dubai. And I'll have a link to that in the show notes. It looked like something that would be a lot of fun to do. For me, even this 56 and a half year old, looks like that would be a lot of fun. Because, you know, you have a parachute on there too, right? Something goes wrong, you just...
Well, I mean, I think that's how you have to land with it. Anyway, you have to deploy your parachute.
He does. Yeah, you do. You land a Cirrus SR-22 style.
Oh, right. Okay. Very cool. And let's see, from Chris Miller in Fairbanks, Alaska. And he says, we're going green. Wait a minute. We're going green. We're going to take care of the earth. We're going green. He says, we're going green. My smile gets bigger every time.
I'm so glad there's not video on me because I think I just did the dorkiest dance possible. Did you really? Oh, yeah.
We do have video on you, and we'll have that if you're watching the video.
Every time I listen to that song, I'm trying to think of a way to turn my car into from a gas-burning car into a beer bottle and beer can, you know, recyclable engine burning type.
Back to the Future style.
Yeah, one of those, what's it called? I forget what it's called, that engine there, but we should do that.
Some of you have suggested other, you know, alternatives to the Going Green theme song, but nothing compares with this.
We're going green. Oh, no.
Now, this is it.
We're going green.
That is it.
In fact, we're gonna take care even if I had a disposition to not go green, I feel like I got to go green because of that song.
Well, how can you not with that song?
What?
Coincidence or not that I'm drinking a Green Man IPA?
I don't think it's a coincidence.
Not a coincidence.
The kind of beer I'm drinking is also green.
And I'm turning green just thinking about the show. I don't know what that means. All right. Let's see. You know what it's time for? It's time for some audio feedback from CJ, the 130 pilot. Take it away, CJ. Come on. CJ, you can do it. Why is this not playing? Okay, let me try it again. Well, you know what? CJ is just going to have to wait.
We'll get back to you.
Yeah, we're going to get back to CJ because he had some great feedback for Dinesh regarding heads-up displays. And honestly, I don't know why it's not playing. So we'll continue. This one from Anthony. On the chance of your job being done by a robot, we talked about this article on episode 170. And he said, you wondered about the difference between a commercial pilot, 54% plus, for being likely that your job would be taken over by a robot, and an airline pilot at 18%. Perhaps their idea of a commercial pilot included those that do pipeline surveys, aerial mapping, etc., tasks that the UAV folks would love to have done by automation. That's probably true.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. As a lawyer with 3.5% chance of being automated, I suppose I should feel good about that. But the notion that there is a 40% chance that the judges to whom I will be arguing will become automated is scary indeed. Computers aren't known to be very good at weighing arguments. I don't think, for much the same reason that they're not good replacements for pilots. Sure, some cases fall nicely within a set of known parameters, but almost invariably there is some aspect that is quirky and needs logic, reason, or compassion filters also applied. Very good point, Anthony.
Yeah, I agree with that. So.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
I think I sent in that article initially. Mm-hmm. I think my for my profession, it was 0.4% chance of being automated. So job security. Woohoo.
Yeah. Well, good for you. Yeah. Meanwhile, you know, Rick and I are going to be
18%.
Well, that's okay. 18%. That's, yeah, that's an 82% chance, right? Wait, 18, 82. Yeah.
And eight. I guess even, and I even more so because I fly boxes.
Yeah. You have a higher percentage of, a higher chance that your job is going to be automated. But as we all know, all we do is we go over there and get in the cockpit and push the button that says take off and land. And that's it, pretty much.
Basically.
Nothing to it.
Nothing to it.
No, not really.
Well, you know, Jim D.
You can do it in 35 hours.
35 hours is all you... 35 minutes.
35 minutes.
Minutes. Oh, I'm sorry. Well,
35 hours is way too much.
Overqualified,
okay.
Then.
Yes. Jim D., says, hey, Cap, Jeff, love your show. I've been listening for a while now and figured I might as well send some feedback. Yeah, it couldn't get any worse. So I had a trip to Washington, D.C. a while back, and on my way there at the airport, we had just boarded a 737, and the cabin doors had been shut. As we began pulling from the gate, I heard a loud snap, and the aircraft stopped moving. The captain came on the PA and explained that the tow bar had broken on the tug. After we got back to the gate, we waited 2 hours before we could get on another flight. So, is this type of mechanical problem common? Has it ever happened to you? Is this caused by exceeding maximum payload the plane can carry? Okay, so, Jim, have I had tow bars break or snap? Yes, many, many times. Not so much lately because I've modified our tow bars in recent years, so that is not something that's not so common anymore. But the fact that you had to wait for 2 hours is kind of has me scratching my head, because usually when we have a tow bar break, it's just a matter of a few minutes for them to get another tow bar or put a new shear pin in the existing tow bar, etc., and then continue the pushback and you're on your way. So it sounds to me like there was something a little bit more involved in this situation, and maybe something that actually damaged the airplane, because, you know, if they had to cancel that flight and you had to get on another flight, you know, that just doesn't seem normal to me. Do you have any experience with broken tow bars, Mr. Rick?
No, actually, it hasn't happened to me yet. I mean, I've been flying airliners for, you know, 10 years now, and I've never had a tow bar issue. And it's interesting what you pointed out. It's not that the tow bar breaks. It's that the fuse,
the shear pin or a fuse or whatever you call it.
The shear pin. That basically it's a weak spot. It's the weakest spot on the tow bar itself. So that it's there to kind of protect the nose landing gear of the airplane. And also, as you're pushing back, you are in constant communications with the mechanic downstairs, and he's telling you, or she's telling you, release brakes, and then start pushing you back. Then once the pushback is done and they tell you to put the brakes back on, you have to make sure that the aircraft is actually stopped, because if they're still pushing you back and you set the parking brake on, then you can really, you know, really, really cause some damage to the tow bar or to the nose landing gear, and that would not be good. So,
yeah,
but no, so far, you know, not, it hasn't.
Yeah, there was a Mad Dog in Boston that happened to not that long ago, that... the captain wasn't really paying close attention to what was going on outside. He thought that the tug driver had called for brakes set, and I guess didn't look outside to see the fact that they were still pushing back, moving, and he set the brakes, and it collapsed the nose gear.
Oops.
And caused lots of damage to the airplane, not to mention a lot of embarrassment to the captain.
Yeah, no kidding.
So, all right. Enough about tow bars. Thank you, Jim D. Daniel from Missouri said, hey, I have an idea for a meetup in 2016. And he sent me a link to the EAA Air Venture in Oshkosh for this year. Of course, he's talking about 2016. But if you want to watch a very cool video of a promotional video for the Air Venture at Oshkosh this year, I'll have a link to that in the show notes. He says, you almost can't say no to that. But Daniel, I have to tell you that we may have to say no to Air Venture in Oshkosh in 2016, because I think we're going over to Farnborough in the UK in 2016.
So however, I might make it over to Air Venture 2015. Yeah, I've been talking to Tyler Herrick, the flight attendant for the mainline carrier, and we're trying to line something up. I actually requested the days off to go up there, and I'm actually looking forward to going up there. I might just make it. It's 90% probable that I might.
Oh, that's so cool. You know, I have a 3-day trip Wednesday, Thursday, Friday of that week. And I was thinking, you know what? I might, you know, be able to go up on Monday or Tuesday, which is, I think the thing starts on Monday. I'm not sure. But
which week is that?
The 20th through the 25th, I think, or 24th, something like that.
Yeah. I'd be, if I go up there, I'd be heading up like on that Monday, Tuesday type time range. So.
Well, unfortunately, I have some appointments back out in Southern California dealing with the whole thing with my mom that I have to take care of, so unfortunately I'm not going to be able to make it this year, but Rick will be there representing the APG community. I'm sure that many of you listening are probably going to be there as well, so look for Miami Rick and say hi and
his gum
and Tyler, of course. Yeah, look for that guy smacking gum and wearing an Acme Airlines shirt. Okay, let's go on with Big Ron. He says, here's a smelly story for you. And he sent me a link to an article in off airlive.net, a Honolulu bound flight on American Airlines. Why am I having so much trouble? A Honolulu bound flight on American Airlines diverted to Los Angeles Sunday morning after three of the six toilets on the eight and a half hour flight stopped working. American Airlines flight 005 had taken off from Dallas-Fort Worth, but the 767-300ER diverted to LA because of the lavatory problems. So, you know, it is important. You think, well, so what? You don't have a toilet. But, you know, things can get pretty bad on an airplane, especially a very, very, very long flight.
Over 8.5 hours.
Yeah.
That's a long time.
I mean, we've heard those stories, you know, like with the 380s with the overflowing, you know, clogged up toilets. And, yeah, just not something you want to. You want to smell the beautiful flowers of those lays around your neck, not the other.
Not pleasant, but maybe also not sanitary as well.
So. Yeah, that's true, too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, thank you, Big Ron, for the pretty smelly story. I don't know if I want to. Matt Maranto says, hey, please tell me the whole story about your nickname, Cuban Kid, in the U.S. Air Force. The details you provided in your reply to my YouTube comment only made me more curious. Okay, so one of the episodes we did, we talked, and I think that there was some, as you said, in the comments of one of the YouTube associated YouTube videos with the show, I talked about the fact that I was at one time nicknamed the Cuban Kid in my squadron. And so let me just try to make this as brief as possible. We were flying our C-141 Starlifter into Gitmo, Guantanamo Bay, Cuba. And for those of you familiar with the airport there, most of the time you land from the east to the west, because just west of the end of the runway, very, very close by, is basically the border, a fence that delineates the area that is designated for the United States and Cuban territory. And there are people there watching that border, et cetera. And so when the winds are very strong, like more than 20 knots out of the east, we are required to land from the west to the east. The problem with that is that you have to make sure that you have a very, very short final turn, final, to keep from overflying Cuban territory. Because if you overfly Cuban territory, you basically have caused a diplomatic situation. And so we were coming in there one day, and it was my leg, you know, very much like the airlines, you know, we kind of alternate legs. And of course, we didn't do a very thorough review of the restrictions manual, which is kind of one of those things that we are supposed to refer to see, you know, if there are any restrictions on whether, you know, I as a co-pilot can fly the airplane or if the aircraft commander has to do it.
So basically you guys had captain only airports, like
yes, and this was one we called them aircraft commanders, and we didn't know that, and so it was my leg, and of course it was a left downwind, left base, and I was thinking to myself, and there's a big like hill on short final there, so you have to be, it's not the, you know, it's kind of dangerous, not dangerous, but it's a challenging,
tricky,
thank you. And so I'm saying, like, okay, you know, let me know when to turn. I could kind of see where the fence was down there, and I'm starting to turn. He goes, no, not yet. And I'm thinking, okay, we need to turn. So we finally got it around. And of course, I'm, you know, way on the right side of the air of the cockpit. I really can't see anything from my vantage point. And we ended up doing our final turn and landing. Well, apparently, as soon as we got on the ground and got to the base operations, we were getting a phone call from somebody who was in one of those little observation posts and said, hey, you guys flew over Cuban airspace. Okay, so if I were the aircraft commander, I would have said, oh, I am so sorry. You know, I'd be very apologetic. I would, you know, mea culpa, I won't do it again, so sorry, blah, blah, blah. I wouldn't argue or anything else. Well, the aircraft commander that I was flying with had a reputation for being a hothead, and he didn't like the fact that this guy was telling him that he overflew Cuban airspace, and he was starting to swear at the guy, and I'm thinking, I'm only hearing this end of the conversation as I'm doing the flight planning for our next leg. I'm thinking, this is not going to turn out well. And I was right. So we took off and headed up to Dover Air Force Base, and not long after we were in the air, we were starting to receive messages from our command unit, or whatever you want to call it, saying that we were basically, once we arrived at Dover, we were going to be put on administrative leave, and an investigation was going to be initiated. And basically, I thought this was the end of my flying career. I really did. I had this.
Did he throw you under the bus, or he just was?
No, it was just
kind of
because
a hothead about it.
He was just a hothead. So basically, the guy, the U.S. Air Force Marine who was in that station, you know, who clearly saw that we overflew the territory. If the guy had said, "I'm sorry," yeah, you're right.
Oh, so it was one of our guys that saw you guys fly. Oh,
but my aircraft commander was such a, what's the right term to use without using bad language, such a jerk about the whole thing and not apologetic, that this kind of upset the guy that was watching this whole thing. And he basically said, okay, screw you, I'm going to, you know, violate you, basically. And
wow.
It just went up the chain. And sure enough, it was turned out to be sort of an international incident. And I really, honestly, when I got to Dover, I'm thinking, okay, well, so much for the flying thing that I was hoping to make my career. And I thought the whole thing was over. I was on administrative leave for just a little bit when I got back to our base in California. But they soon realized that, you know, I didn't know what I was doing, and I was a new guy. And, you know, so the guy that was the aircraft commander, who was also an instructor pilot, ended up getting his instructor's, you know, credentials revoked and became a non-instructor line pilot. And he was on leave for quite a considerable amount of time before they started letting him fly again. But that's why the guys at my squadron back in California called me the Cuban kid, because I was the one that was, oh, by the way, guess what? I was not allowed to be flying the airplane into that airport when you were landing that direction. And if we had referenced the appropriate manual, we would have known that. So a lot, I learned a lot of lessons from that incident, and but I'm just so glad that it wasn't the end of my career. And so that's why they call me the Cuban Kid. Not very long, though. Most people forgot about it after a little bit of time.
That's a good story.
10 though. Years. Yeah.
But, you know, the thing about it is that if anytime you do something wrong, and I can tell you some other stories where this is the same kind of takeaway. If you do something wrong and you know you've done something wrong, don't start, you know, going after the person that's telling you you've done something wrong and make it sound like it was their fault and not yours, because it's just going to get, it's going to go from bad to worse.
Yeah. And honesty is always the best policy. Just.
Yeah. And just be apologetic. So, you know, yeah, sure. I think you're absolutely right. I'm sorry. Sorry seems to be. But that was not the case in this situation. So that is an abbreviated story about the Cuban Kid. Mike sent me some feedback regarding a flight dispatcher. I think that somebody had asked about, I think it was Frick that had asked about becoming a flight dispatcher. And so Mike sent me this feedback. So let's hear what he has to say. Okay. Is none of this going to play for me? Yeah. Okay. So apparently I figured out what the problem is. My Evernote application is just not working. I'm going to restart it and see if that helps.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And in the meantime.
Yeah. So, Miami Rick, did you do any flying this week?
No, actually I've been, you know what? It's interesting because, yesterday I posted, a little picture on Twitter, cause I'm playing this little, you know,
oh, I saw that.
Simulator
yep.
on my iPhone 6.
That was kind of late at night, wasn't it?
It was, you know, I'm a night owl like that, you know, just freight dog, and it's taking its toll on me. So mm-hmm. I'm up at all hours. Actually, the last time I actually landed the airplane was back on the 10th of June. And that's interesting because on these really, really long flights and, you know, basically the kind of flying that I do, you only get to fly and you only get to land the airplane maybe, you know, once or twice a month. And it's been kind of slow, you know, the last couple of days. Well, I'm not complaining because I've had a lot of time to be at home, and then I've done a couple of simulator sessions. I've been to the office a couple of times. You know, we did the meetup up in IED. That was a lot of fun. But looking forward to getting back up there on the 6th and getting some flying done. But since I haven't been doing a lot of flying, I actually I'm keeping my hand flying skills sharp-ish with this little game here, and it's actually a lot of fun. So, yeah, you probably done a lot more flying than I have lately.
No, actually, not really. The last time I flew was actually the beginning of May.
Really?
Yeah, that's unusual for me, but it's been busy.
It's interesting because, like, for us, we need to we actually have. And captains and both captains and NFOs have this form, and it's kind of this kind of like one of those Excel charts where you plot down the date, you know, the registration of the airplane, where you took off from, where you landed, and whether you flew as pilot flying, pilot monitoring, and if you flew as pilot flying, did you do the takeoff, the landing, or just the takeoff, or just the landing? And mm-hmm. you're supposed to tally up at least. You have to have at least 3 takeoffs and landings in a 3-month period to sure. stay current. If you don't, then you have to go back to the simulator and do your 3 touch and goes and the level D simulator. These things are so right. real that it's like flying the real airplane. So you can be signed off that way. But it hasn't gotten to that point with me yet. But I'm looking forward to going back up there
to and flying for real. Yeah,
and doing a little hand flying
for reals. Hey, let me see if this works. No.
No.
What is going on with this thing?
I don't know.
Well, while you're working on that, I'll take care of some administrative stuff, too.
Yeah.
Speaking of Twitter, I was on the last episode, I think I gave the impression that I was not such a fan of Greenville, North Carolina, because I told you that there was you weren't missing out on anything by not having been there. And I got called out for that on Twitter. So my apologies to anyone who lives in Greenville, North Carolina, and particularly Israel Mueller.
See, that's a problem when you have thousands and thousands of listeners.
I know. There's people everywhere. So, no, that's not the case at all. There's, you know, I definitely am very appreciative of my time that I spent in Greenville, North Carolina. And if you have not been, reasons to go. I was trying to think of a few. So, the best barbecue in the world, hands down, is in Greenville, North Carolina at Bee's Barbecue. So, that is a great reason to go. And another complimentary thing I'll say about Greenville is that if I hadn't lived there, I would have never been a pilot. So there you go.
Yeah, and both those statements were brought to you by Miami Mike's ear-piercing sugar-free peppermint gum. When you need your fresh breath to make a statement. With you, Captain Jeff.
Miami Mike.
Yeah, that guy. That guy chewing gum.
All right. Well, I'm going to see if I can find Dispatcher Mike's feedback in my email, because for some reason the Evernote connected version is not working. So let me see what happens if I hit this button.
Okay. Hello, Captain Jeff.
Here we go.
Crew. It's Dispatcher Mike calling. I've got to
turn the volume up.
Wilderness of West Central Georgia. It's very early in the morning. The wildlife is starting to come to life in my backyard. Just got off my shift, so I figured I'd give some voice feedback for Frick. Down in South Africa, about thinking about becoming a dispatcher and an expat. At Acme, I think I know of about maybe two dispatchers that are expats. One of them's from the UK and the other one's from the tiny island of Bermuda. Both of those guys got into dispatching at Acme through other departments at Acme. They're almost internal hires and internal transfers into the flight control department. Frick, for you though, the one airline that I do know of worldwide that takes a lot of expats is Emirates. Emirates, from what I know, has a pretty lucrative package for people that are willing to move their family to Dubai. They provide housing, they provide automobiles and transportation. They pretty much provide everything and good schooling for your children to go and work for Emirates. There is a commitment for all of that, but that's pretty much all I know about it. I know Emirates is one of the few foreign carriers that requires licensed and preferred FAA licensed dispatchers to run their airline. So that's what I have to say about that. As United States expats, a lot of it probably be internal candidates moving to the United States, especially with the United States work visas and immigration laws. That probably is a hindrance to that. And Jeff and Rick, and another comment listening to the last episode, you guys were talking about ELTs. And it just reminded me of a funny story that happened to me. Rick, like you, I have also set off an ELT on landing, except mine was during my commercial check ride for my commercial pilot certificate. It was engine out. The DPE put me right over a small private airport where her airplane was based at, which she told me in advance that it was okay to land there. And there's just a small dip in the runway. I thought I had a pretty smooth runway, and just the main landing gear came airborne again, hit the dip, and boom, all of a sudden I start hearing the whoop whoop of an ELT, which coincidentally it just happened to be the first time I've heard an ELT go off before. She goes, yeah, I think that's us. And luckily there was a mechanic there, so we pulled off onto the ramp, jumped out of the airplane, the mechanic reset the ELT, and almost instantaneously I'm like, man, I just set off the ELT on my commercial check ride. I'm pretty sure I'm going to have to take this again. It took off a lot of stress off the flight, and I passed my check ride then and continued on the rest of the flight doing the lazy H and the Chandelles and all those harder maneuvers to do, and I got it passed. But you know, you guys talked about setting off ELTs. I just thought I'd share that story as well. Jeff, I hope you guys had a good time with the CNMC and your other life and ministry. this last past weekend. I hope it was a good success. So from the wilderness of West Central Georgia, I'm signing off, APG community. You guys have a good one.
Thank you, Dispatcher Mike, and it was a great experience. Thank you for you know that. And
I'm glad I'm not alone in the South. The funny thing is that after that landing, I'm a lot like you, Captain Jeff. I like to, no matter how bad the landing was, I have to step out of the flight deck and go say goodbye to the passengers. And some of the looks I got were like, man, yeah. Thanks a lot for that landing. It was, but interestingly enough, there's nothing on the practical test standards at PTS for the commercial license that says that you cannot set an ELT.
Nope,
basically, you're not tested on that. So
it's not in there.
If you set it up, if you set it off, you set it off.
It's extra credit.
There you go.
You know what? It reminds me when you said, after that happening, he's thinking, oh, there's no way that I'm going to pass my check. It's like a big, huge weight lifted off your shoulders thinking, well, now it's just, I'm just getting good experience for the next time that I try to get my commercial license. And that reminds me of a situation where I had when I went to US Air for an interview, and we at US Air required that we go into a simulator. I think I've talked about this story on a previous episode. Mm-hmm. But it was such, because I screwed up just about everything they told us not to screw up. I'm thinking, well, this whole thing is just a waste of time, and it's just an experience of interviewing with a major airline that I can kind of put in my back pocket, and I might as well enjoy the rest of it. And turns out that they actually asked me to come back, which again, I was very surprised, but I understand that.
Well, the thing is that when you're interviewing for an airline, you're nervous. I remember the first time I interviewed for an airline. I mean, I didn't know what to expect. You kind of read the gouge, online. You talk to people that have actually gone through the process. But I mean, until you're there, you really don't know how to handle. Well, you know how to handle yourself, but it's you're in a position where you've never been before. You've never experienced or gone through that before, so you're nervous, and a lot of things kind of start going wrong, and then you have that am I not going to get the job thing in the back of your head, and that causes you to underperform, and it's an interesting feeling, but it happens sometimes.
Well, I was going to say, for the commercial check ride, they're part of what they're evaluating too, or the examiner's evaluating, is how professionally do you handle situations like that. Mm-hmm. They expect that not everything is going to go perfectly 100% of the time, and situations are going to arise that require attention. And if you can deal with it in a professional manner and move on from it and, fly the rest of the check ride without incident or not let it affect you, basically, then
right.
That's fantastic.
So. That's exactly right. That's what they're looking at. How did this person handle a bad situation, and can they continue to operate safely? So yep. Good point. Yep. I'm going to try to play CJ's, CJ the C-130 pilot's feedback okay. through this email version. Let's see if this works.
Hey, Kevin, Jeff from the APG community. It's CJ the C-130 pilot. This is in response to episode 166, where there was a question from Danish, otherwise known as Chocolate Danish. Now I'm hungry. What was I talking about again? Oh, yes. A question from Danish about the use of a heads-up display, or HUD. I fly the latest model of the C-130, which comes equipped with two HUDs, one for each pilot. The aircraft is certified to fly with the HUD as a primary reference, so we do not normally have the pilot's flight display, which includes the attitude indicator and horizontal situation display, displayed on any of our screens. So a visitor to the cockpit may be unnerved to see that there are no visible artificial horizons other than the tiny standby ADI. The system will automatically turn on the pilot's display if the HUD fails or is moved out of the on position. One advantage of the HUD is that it requires each pilot to sit in exactly the right spot to place their eyes in the field of view of the HUD. That is, that way each pilot will have exactly the same references. Our HUD is focused at infinity, so the horizon line is superimposed directly on the actual horizon. Another advantage is that small changes in pitch or bank are immediately visible, since the HUD takes up about 40 degrees of your field of view. So you're able to fly a very precise pitch of bank angle. While we're learning to fly with the system, the instructors required us to turn on all the information from the get-go,
so we can learn quickly what to look for and what to filter out in our brains rather than having to rely on a declutter function. For example, in the HUD you'll see not only basic pitch, airspeed, and altitude information, but also vertical speed, radar altitude, DME, G-meter, and the mini CDI. For airdrop and low level, even more symbology shows up on the HUD. One of the really cool features is that you can plug in an airport, shoot an approach to it, and the HUD will draw the outline of the runway in such a way that it is superimposed on the actual edges of the runway. You can imagine that's really cool for low visibility or low ceiling situations. Some disadvantages of the HUD are that you have to constantly fiddle with the brightness around dusk and dawn as you turn away or into the sun. In some situations, the sun might be setting just behind the airspeed indicator, so you have no idea how fast you're going without pulling out the pilot's display on a heads-down screen. I would say the biggest disadvantage of the HUD is that you end up feeling naked without it. They only make us fly two approaches with it without it every 6 months, and I always feel like a T-37 student since I get so used to being able to see outside and see my gauges at the same time. It's so much easier to get off altitude or airspeed when you have to look back and forth between the instrument panel and out the window. So there you have it. Overall, I think the HUD's a great piece of kit, and ours has thus far been super reliable, knock on wood. It definitely makes me look like a better pilot than I am. So, I hope a HUD comes to the Mad Dog soon, and as always, Cavu to you.
Thank you, CJ, for that. And
wow, lots of information in the heads-up display.
Yeah.
I didn't realize it had so much.
I didn't either. And the fact that, you know, it basically removes all of the other attitude indicator displays in the cockpit. I could imagine if you're sitting in the jump seat and you're going, where's the attitude indicator?
Something's missing here.
Yeah.
Remember Daniel's comment, Daniel Matisse's comment about the 787 HUD. Well, he flies a 787 for Avianca. Mm-hmm. And he said that when you decelerate and you either step on the brakes a little harder, the auto brake system is set to a level where the deceleration rate is kind of, you know, steep. The HUD will actually move out of the way so you don't hit it with your head. I thought that was a...
Yeah, that is a great
design.
That
was really interesting.
Like, I know this guy's going to get his head on this because we're decelerating so quickly.
Wow, they thought of everything.
Yeah.
Technology is so smart.
Very.
I don't know.
Well, Joe Serrano writes, "Good day, Captain Jeff. I had a question on fixes and when you're told to go to a certain fix. What happens when you reach that fix? Do you hang around until you're cleared to the next fix? Or do you get a new fix or vector before you get there? Also, if you haven't read the blog Jethead's blog, he has a good view of what he thinks is important about flying in country instead of flying around the world. Anyway, enjoy your podcast. Look forward to the next one every week." Well, thank you, Joe. So your fix question, when you're told to go to a certain fix, what happens when you reach that fix? Well, usually if you're told to fly to a fix, it is assumed, if they don't say, proceed direct to so-and-so fix and resume navigation, which you hear quite often, you just make the assumption that that's what that means, that you, whatever your filed routing is beyond that fix is what they're expecting you to do. Now, sometimes you end up reaching a clearance limit fix, and when that happens, technically, if they haven't told you anything else and you haven't queried about it, you are expected to enter a holding pattern. So, but that's very unusual. Usually they'll expect you to do something other than just starting a holding pattern, a standard pattern at that fix at that point. So sometimes things get a little bit busy. You get a clearance limit fix clearance and you know that they don't want you to do that. And so you try to get a word in edgewise and try to clarify what the routing is beyond that fix. But, as I said, in general, the fix that you are cleared to assumes that you will continue whatever your filed routing is.
Right. It's a standard pattern for you guys and gals is basically you fly in on the course that you were cleared to the fix, and then you do a right turn. Now, there's another thing, an interesting thing here. Well, what happens when, if for example, you lose all communications with ATC? And I'm talking about the approach portion of the flight. A lot of times you'll get cleared to fixes because the airport airspace itself is so busy with airplanes that they actually have to make you hold at specific fixes throughout the standard terminal arrival procedure to make room for the airplanes that are closer to the airport to land, and then you make room for you so you can land. When they clear you to a fix that way, they're going to give you what's called an EFC, which stands for estimated further clearance. And basically what that means is that you're going to that figure has two purposes. The first one is you put that number, that time, on your flight management computer, and your flight management computer, based on the altitude that you're flying at, and the amount of fuel that you have on board, is going to give you the maximum predicted hold time over that fix, and that's going to help you to make a decision whether to proceed to your original destination airport or to divert to your alternate airport. And the other thing is, as I just mentioned, is you have to keep in mind that if you lose your radios, you lose comm capability with air traffic control, you're not going to stay on that fix holding forever and ever because you don't have the fuel to do it. So if that happens and you get to your estimated further clearance time and you lose contact with ATC, you're supposed to hold on that fix until your EFC, and then at your EFC, proceed to the approach procedure and shoot the approach procedure and land while squawking, while setting a transponder code of 7600, which basically means lost comms. Air traffic control is going to be able to see that, pick that up on their radar screens, and see that you basically have no communications with ATC, and they'll basically clear everybody out of the way and allow you to land without being able to talk to ATC. So that's the two situations that I can think of there.
Right. Basically, they're going to expect you to follow your flight plan, but with the with whatever instructions they gave you. So,
right.
Yep.
Yeah.
Very good. That's exactly right. And regarding the Jethead blog and the article regarding, you know, flying domestic and flying international, it really has to do with flying maybe narrow bodies and wide bodies. And so the title of the blog post is Little Boeing, Big Life. And so I think that this guy does a good job of explaining why some people, like myself, decide to end up staying on a narrow-body airplane and experiencing seniority as opposed to, you know, flying the international wide-body stuff and maybe not having as much seniority. And it goes into a lot of detail about, you know, different time zones, et cetera, and the ability, in this guy's case, the ability to be home every night and sleep in the same bed every night. Now, that's not my reality. My reality is a little bit different. But anyway, he makes some very good points about, you know, flying the little Boeing and not the big Boeings, and how that changes your lifestyle. So I'll include a link to that in the show notes. So we just talked about the feedback regarding, you know, what happens when you go to a fix. And Rick, you kind of mentioned what would happen if you were cleared for something and then you had an EFC and, you know, what they would expect.
And just before we go on there, I just want to make sure that I said it right. EFC is expect further clearance. I thought I said estimated further clearance. EFC.
Yes, and you're Skyping up terribly all of a sudden, but yes, expect further clearance time is what that stands for, EFC. But estimated further clearance time, that sounds okay too.
Okay.
But regarding that, you mentioned squawking 7600 on our transponder, and that reminded me of some feedback that I received from Jim Howard, and he kind of has a little rant, so let's hear what Jim has to say.
Hello, Captain Jeff. This is Jim Howard in Texas, and I'm sitting in a Piper Archer that belongs to the Shondell Flying Club, of which I've been a member for, I think, at least 12 years. And I had planned to do an in-flight announcement and show you some of the features of this airplane and then ask a question. However, instead of all of that, I have to share my outrage, and then I have a question. I came in, our club has an online system for keeping track of the airplanes. I checked that, no maintenance items. We have a logbook in the airplane where maintenance items are also supposed to be documented. Nothing wrong with the airplane according to that. I get in here, I plug in my headset, and I get a squeal. And I see my headset's kind of old, but I got a second one, so I put the second one in, same thing. I start fooling with the radios. There's one, there's our new tech radio there and our old tech radio here. None of them work. Nothing works. And I'm thinking, is it my headset or what? And then I look down at the transponder, Now, for those in the audience who don't know what a transponder is, it's a radar beacon. ATC radar hits the airplane, and the transponder sends back an eight-digit octal number that's just a code, helps them identify us. And there's special codes. One of the special codes is 7600. That's in the airplane. What that means is the last guy who flew this had these radios fail in flight. I suspect it was the intercom panel up here that failed, since it was a common mode failure, killed both radios. So he came back knowing, telling the world that he didn't have radios, but he didn't put it in the logbook, and he didn't put it in our online system. So I came out here, got all hot and sweaty, pre-flight in this airplane, got all excited, tried to listen to the radio, dead. So I'm outraged. I'm kill, destroy. No, okay, so enough of that. Thank you for listening to me. I do have a question real quick, though.
Before he goes on to his question, I think the first time that somebody has sent me some feedback with video feedback. Maybe not, but it's one of the first.
That's cool.
And so he's showing the instrument panel. I know that Dr. Steph and Miami Rick can't see this, but he's talking to us while he's taking this video with his phone or whatever he's taking with, and it's showing the instrument panel of this Piper and showing the transponder panel, and it says 7600. And then when he was expressing his outrage, his hand was like, I want to strangle someone.
I did watch the video. I saw it.
So. Yeah, it's a very, very well done. So he's going to go on with a actual question.
Two episodes ago, I think, and that was about airline pilots, you know, doing minor mistakes, like, you know, landing with the and setting off the ELT, or landing and not writing up a significant problem with the airplane, if that was ever to happen. Just little things. Now, you're not going to fire a pilot that you got all this money in if you're an airline executive, you know, because he makes a small mistake. But I'm sure of that. But my question is this. Do you have, in a legacy airline like Acme, do you have any sort of demerit system? Like, if you had a pilot who was making little errors consistently, maybe landings that set off, you know, out of the touchdown zone, like Rick talked about, or, you know, other just little minor things that each one by itself was not a big deal, but at some point is enough too much. So I'm just curious whether if there's punishments or things that happen somewhere between your seniority number XXX, so you can do YYY, that's it, or you need to come talk to the chief pilot and he's going to tell you to do A or B or C or kick you out the door. So I'm just curious if there's like a demerit system or something for you legacy pilots if you make a series of small mistakes, that one, each one being minor, but as may perhaps as a taken as a trend would be concerning. So thank you for the podcast, and thanks to the APG community, and thanks for listening to my outrage at my fellow club member leaving this set on 7600 and not telling me the radios were out. Have a good afternoon, and check six.
Thank you again, Jim, for sending that video feedback. And so, you know, unless the FAA is aware of something and brought into the whole situation, you know, as far as little things happening and, you know, a certain amount adding up to make something into a big thing. I mean, I've heard through the grapevine that my company does keep records on all of us, and, you know, good things and bad things, and they have a file and all that kind of stuff. I don't know if that's real or it's just folklore. I'm not sure. I can say that I've never been called in and had to talk to a chief pilot and I'm putting a big giant file, you know, thump down on the desk and starting to look through it. So I don't know really what the answer is at Acme Airlines. I do know that, again, if there's something that happens that, you know, required you to fill out an ASAP form or a NASA form, you know, that you know clearly that you violated something like an altitude restriction or whatever, and the FAA is involved, then it's likely that you're going to receive some kind of action or reaction, like a extra training or whatever. But it had to be something really, really serious for you to get fired, because in my airline, we have a pilots union, who is there to act as your advocate and make sure that you're just not, you know, fired for whatever reason. You know, there's going to be some due process involved in it. Unless it's really, really egregious, you're not going to, you know, you may have some time off. You may have some extra training, but you're not going to get fired.
Yeah, well, right. he brings up some good points for any of the general aviation folks out there who fly rental aircraft often. You know, it's a good rule of thumb to just assume that you don't know who flew the plane last and you don't know what they may have done to that airplane. So you want to make sure that your pre-flight is very thorough, your walk around is thorough. I found all kinds of interesting things on pre-flights before, you know, anything from minor things such as, you know, avionics being left on to one time I came out and there were bird guts on the landing gear door that Ooh. No one had noticed apparently. Just be thorough. So
and write it up if you had a problem
right.
Or, you know, don't be an idiot. And if you had a problem with the radios and you didn't want anybody to know, then squawk 1200. I'm not suggesting that you cover up something because you have to be concerned about the people that are going to be flying the airplane after you.
Yeah. I mean, again, right. Honesty is always the best. Things happen to these airplanes and it's probably most of them are not the fault of the person flying it at that time. You know, radios go out for whatever reason. Write it up, make sure the next person doesn't have the same problem.
Well, taking into account or figuring that everything went all right in the last flight, what are you supposed to squawk once you're done with the transponder? Well, what we do as our post-flight procedure, after landing procedure, we'll actually set the transponder to 2000, which is the code that you're supposed to have on when you don't have a transponder code assigned. 1200, as everybody knows out there, is basically squawk VFR. Right. I've actually had when we do the short leg from Amsterdam to Frankfurt, we're actually told to squawk at 1000. You know, that's and every airplane that flies that short hopper or within Europe and on, you know, very, very short hops, everybody squawks 1000, which I thought, you know, I figured that was, you know, that was kind of interesting. I had never seen that before. But after you land, you'll set the transponder to 2000, which basically means that you have not been assigned a transponder code. So that's what you're supposed to do. And as far as a demerit program for us in my airline, if you start seeing a pattern there where, you know, a certain guy or gal starts landing long a little bit, you know, too often or landing hard a little bit too often or having to a few too many unstabilized approaches, and then, you know, that can obviously start sending off some red flags there. But we have a program called the AQD program, which basically means that if we think that we busted we flew an unstabilized approach, or we think that we landed a little hard, or we think that we landed a little long, kind of we fill one of these reports out, and that's one of those things where we're kind of protecting ourselves, kind of protecting our certificate from the certificating agency wherever country we're flying in, and we're kind of protecting ourselves from the from the chief pilot to try to, you know, get them off our back. But the thing is that, you know, if you start seeing a pattern there, then, you know, definitely that's something that's going to count against you, and you want to stay away from that because it's just not safe.
And at Acme Airlines, when we finish a flight and we shut down the transponder, we always just zero it out.
Oh, you zero it out? Really?
Yeah, 0000.
Okay.
That's what we do. But, you know, every airline's different, apparently.
Hmm. Yeah. I mean, in general aviation, it usually goes back to 1200, and then usually you just turn the transponder off. So.
Yeah. Depends. Yeah, ours goes to standby and then just 00. And that just is an indication. You look down at it and you go, oh, obviously we haven't put in our discrete squawk.
Interesting thing with the transponder is that a lot of airports have what's called ground radar, which basically require you to have your transponder mm-hmm. on, but not on altitude reporting, but just on, so that ATC, the ground controllers know where you are based on your assigned transponder code, and they're able to kind of, you know, not vector you, but give you your taxi directions and low visibility conditions. That's interesting.
Yeah, most of the airports that we operate in and out of, or a lot of them anyway, the big hubs require that we always have our transponder in before we even push back, and that's part of our checklist. So, and we always turn it on before we actually start moving backwards on our pushback. Interesting. Oh, everything's a little bit different, you know. Not everybody is the same.
Bow.
Sock.
Bam.
Blammo.
Batman. 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 Starring Adam West. Ah, there's a hint. Okay, you're wondering.
Yes, but who played Robin?
Oh, let me see. Wap, Biff, oof, it doesn't say. Who did?
I don't know.
Oh.
Oh, really?
I thought you knew.
I thought you had.
I'm sorry. No. I was asking an honest question. I don't know.
It only said Adam West for Batman on this particular YouTube video. With the cartoon characters, etc. So you're wondering, Jeff, why are you playing the Batman theme? Well, it's because Scott Shields sent this article in. Let me start reading this. We all know that booking a flight is a constant tactical battle with airlines. But no passenger has won or lost the booking war as heroically as 19-year-old Adam Armstrong, the student from Manchester, England. Well, he changed his name to Adam West because it was cheaper than changing his Ryanair flight booking. The airline wanted to charge him $337 to change a mistake on his ticket. He told The Sun that his stepfather accidentally booked him as Adam West because that's what he called himself on his Facebook page. Her stepdad got my name from Facebook, but I had put it as Adam West as a joke because he was the actor who played Batman on TV. And Ryanair is known for its cheap flights, but ample fees for any changes or services. And it talks about, you know, it charges $69 to check in at the airport and instead of checking in before you get to the airport for free. And the airline wanted to charge West twice for his change because he and his girlfriend were both on the booking. But instead of giving in, the teen went rogue. He changed his name for free and will fly to Ibiza as Adam West next week. The Guardian reports that he did have to pay about $157 to change his passport. I guess they didn't think of everything. But, you know, I think in the United States, it's not free to change your name, is it?
I think there's a fee.
Yeah, I think so too.
I don't think it's a difficult process, but I think there's a fee.
But it's not like just filling out a form and for nothing you change your name because people would be changing their names all the time. Like right. Like Jenner.
Yeah. Well, I think it involves going to the eventually to the Social Security office, and that's just
Yeah.
No one wants to go there.
That alone in the DMV would keep me away from doing
it. Yeah.
I just pay my fee to Ryanair. Or just not take the trip. Yeah. Oh, well. Well, thank you, Scott, for sending in that little bit of information.
Quick aside here, too. So the actor who played Robin on Batman, the TV series, his name was Burt Ward.
Of course. Burt. Oh, Ward.
Okay. Burt Ward.
Wasn't, what was the character's name was Ward, wasn't it, in Batman? Bruce. Wasn't it Bruce Ward?
Bruce Wayne.
No, Bruce Wayne.
Oh, never mind.
And he had a bright red phone that he talked to Commissioner Gordon through, and then he lived in a cave or something.
I thought the series was in black and white.
No, it started in black and white, and then it became color.
Oh, okay.
Stephanie, quit making fun of old people. Technicolor. Okay, let's move on before this just goes completely down the tubes. Yep, it's probably too late. Joe Driver sends in. Oh, I know I have this still in here. On the last show, I talked about somebody who said that he found this show from Mr. Aviation 101, that guy's videos, and it was Joe Driver. And so again, Mr. Aviation 101, great videos about flying and learning how to fly, etc. He had a great video about him flying into Long Beach, and then they had the abort situation on takeoff at a Long, I'm not Long Beach, Big Bear Airport.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So just wanted to acknowledge that it was Joe Driver that sent me that piece of feedback. So thank you, Joe. Okay, and I'm not sure who this is. All I got was the email address, and the email is liquidfire75. And you know, the question is regarding the pros and cons of being a cargo pilot versus a pilot for a passenger airline. And I'm thinking to myself, I wonder if there's somebody that I know that could probably answer this question with a, you know, have some kind of perspective about this. And then I thought, no, so we'll move on to...
Yeah, I can't think of anybody.
Oh, so, okay, here he goes. I'm not sure if you have touched on this topic before, but this is a question directed to both yourself and Miami Rick. I was wondering if both of you could share your views on the pros and cons of being a cargo pilot versus a pilot for a passenger airline. Does one offer more home time, pay, or fun and adventure than the other? Personally, I would imagine that not having to deal with passengers can be a good thing at times, but I often wonder if the late night, early morning cargo flying takes a toll on one's health. What do you think, Rick?
Well, yeah, I mean, I tell you, and it's for those of you guys that and gals that don't know, I've flew both passengers and now I fly cargo, and I can tell you that flying cargo, it's got its pros. You know, you have for example, you don't always go to the same places. You do a lot of charter flying. You go to a lot of airports that are kind of, you know, quote unquote, off the beaten path. You basically, like, for example, me, I have a flight roster assigned to me, and I have a number of trips that I do in a certain period of time, but that's just on paper. As my week or trip progresses, then the trips might actually get delayed, or they might actually get pushed up, or the destinations might all, you know, altogether change. So you have to be prepared for all sorts of things. You basically have to learn how to pack for every kind of weather in a very, very small roll aboard suitcase, because you just don't know where you might end up. As far as the time at home, well, particularly for my airline and my base, I'm based out of Miami. I'm lucky because in my case, the cargo division is based out of Miami. So for the guys that actually live in, for example, Santiago, Chile, or Montevideo, Uruguay, or Buenos Aires, Argentina, they first need to make it up to Miami before they can actually start their flying their trips. So that means that they're away from home a lot more than I am, because I'm already here. So that's why I'll do, you know, maybe a 6, 7, 8 day trip at most, and then I'm home for, you know, we usually have 4 or 5 days off for just basically for every pilot. But I actually have more time off because I don't have to use my time off to fly down to wherever I live. I just stay here and I don't have to use those days, which means that I have more time off than other people do. So that's a good thing there. Pay-wise, that also depends on the airline. We are, unlike Captain Jeff's airline, we are a salary-based airline. So we fly up to hour 60 in the month, and then over anything over the 60th hour, we get paid a certain dollar amount over that hour, over that 60-hour mark, up until the 90-hour mark, which is our legal limit. And then let me see here, some of the cons. Well, I fly the 777 freighter, which is a very long-range airplane. It's based on the 777-200 long-range from the LR. And as I said, it's a very long-range airplane, which means that the flight sectors, a lot of the long flight sectors are over 12 hours long, which means that the flight itself is long, but you're also awake for a lot longer. So for a 12-hour flight, for example, I might be up for 24, 36, even 40 hours at a time, which is why, as Captain Jeff and Dr. Steph knows, I'm a bit of a night owl, because I've kind of gotten used to
being up for a long, long time. Another con is that...
I was going to say, I think I got a text message from Miami Rick at like 1 o'clock in the morning last Friday night.
Yeah, so I'm a bit of an night owl. Also, some of the cargo that we carry has to be flown by cargo airplane because it's you're dealing with specific cargo that's too dangerous or flammable or unsafe to be carried on passenger airplanes. So that's something that you have to kind of deal with there. Being awake for that long and, you know, flying across so many time zones and all, it does take a little bit of a toll on your health, but only if you let it. That's why I try to, you know, eat right. I try to stay healthy. I try to go to the gym a lot. I try to stay very, very hydrated. I just basically do what my body asks me to do. If I'm tired, I'll sleep. If I'm hungry, I'll eat. I'll never force my body into having lunch at 4 a.m. And why am I saying this? Because there's certain people that they think that the best way to go is for them to basically keep their normal body clock based on where they live. Well, then that may work for them, but it doesn't work for me. So you just kind of make basically you make do with what you have, and you make the system work for you. And that's kind of how it's kind of what I got with cargo flying. Passenger flying is a lot more. It's very structured. The trips that you get assigned each month, the trips that you bid are the trips that you're going to get based on your seniority. You know that you're going to leave on a certain day and be back on a certain day. You know that all the trips that are there are the trips that you're going to fly, that you're going to depart at a certain time, arrive at a certain time. And not so much with cargo. Cargo is very dynamic. It's ever-changing. And it really takes a special kind of pilot to do it because, you know, it's not everyone's cup of tea. So, yeah.
Yeah. And here in the U.S., you know, the carriers that you think of as being cargo carriers are FedEx and UPS. And they do fly some of their flight segments during daylight, but most, I think, majority of their flying is at night. And it can, you know, really mess with your circadian rhythm.
And it's interesting because actually I was asked a question a couple of weeks ago. Well, why is it that cargo, the bulk of the cargo flying is done at night? Well, you think about it, you got to move the cargo from point A to point B to get it to the distribution center before sunrise so you can get out the trucks, and then the trucks can deliver it during office hours. It's a pretty simple and straightforward answer, but you know, not a lot of people know that. That's why the bulk of our flying is done at night.
Mm-hmm. But on the other hand, it's kind of nice when you're just flying a bunch of cargo around. You don't have to worry about passengers and their safety and turbulence and all that kind of stuff, and always talking to them and communicating. And, you know, there are pros and cons to everything. But I do know that I can tell you that several of the co-pilots that I've flown with in the last several years were flying for UPS or FedEx. And they left those airlines and took a cut in seniority and starting over with Acme because they said, you know what, it's for me and my body and my mentality, I couldn't see myself doing this for another 25, 30, 35 years, that I thought it would kill me. And, you know, so I think it really depends on the person as well.
Yeah, yeah. Like I said, it takes a special kind of pilot. It's not everyone's cup of tea, as I said. But if you like it, if it's something that jives with you, and if you make it work for you, and if you take care of yourself and stay healthy, hydrated, exercise, and eat right, then you know, it should be no problem. That's at least how I do it.
Rick is a monster. we roomed together up in Washington D.C., and he was like up at the, you know, before the crack of dawn, going to exercise in the gym, and I'm thinking, yeah, you're crazy, and I kept sleeping.
I'd had like 4 hours of sleep, I think it was.
Yeah,
it's just that, you know, it's one of those things where, like, for example, I can't get dressed in the morning unless I shower first, and I can't shower first unless I work out first. So it's one of those things where, you know, kind of like we're talking about turning on the engines and flipping the switches and the knobs in the right sequence. That's the right sequence for me to get started. You know, I just can't get started unless I do it in that sequence. So that's just how I am.
I have very little patience for stupidity.
Exactly. Now let me chew a piece of gum here.
No, you're
a, no, he.
You're a very special person.
Yeah, he definitely put us to shame. Because I think both of those mornings I was like, yeah, I'm going to get up and I'm going to go for a run. And then I slept in.
So. I mean, I was like, there's no way that he's going to get up after very little sleep. And sure enough, he did. He worked out for like 2 hours. And I'm thinking, gosh darn it. That guy's crazy.
We've got some work to do.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Well, thank you very much. Liquid Fire 75, whoever you are. By the way, just a reminder, if you send some feedback to airlinepilotguy.com, I don't know why we don't get your actual real name unless you include it in the body of the message. And so if you would like me to refer to your actual name, make sure you put that in there for me. So, Nir, I think, from Israel, sent this picture. He said, I thought you'd like this picture. And it's a picture of a, I think it's like a coffee bag or something. And it says, Lord, give me coffee to change the things I can change and wine to accept the things I can't.
That's good.
Wise words, yes.
Yes. Kind of like the, what is that prayer called?
The, serenity.
Serenity prayer. Thank you. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Just a little bit of a different version of that. That's like me. It's caffeine.
The practical version.
Yeah. Caffeine to, you know, for the uppers and alcohol for the downers. Keeps there you it all go. Regulated. All right. James Keene. Oh, wait a minute.
I know what you're going to do.
James Keene writes, I love that. I propose all Acme flights should take off vertically as demonstrated in this video in the future. So he sends me a link, abcnews.go.com, about a 787 Dreamliner makes dizzying takeoff test flight. This is for the practice session at Farnborough just a few weeks back. Of course, we know that it wasn't actually a vertical takeoff. The angle of the video made it look like it was a vertical takeoff, but it wasn't actually. But it was impressive. And we mentioned this before, you know, any airplane that is very, very light and using its maximum takeoff thrust can make an impressive takeoff, that's for sure.
Yeah, and it's interesting because I think we should point out here that, I mean, when you take off is you're basically trying to maintain what's called a V2 to V2 plus 15 speed. And V2 is your single engine safety speed, which means that if an engine fails, you're going to maintain that airspeed, and that airspeed is going to guarantee you that you're going to clear all the obstacles ahead of you on flying on one engine. And the way it works is that once you get to a certain altitude, the automatic flight director system is going to pitch for either V2 plus 15 up to V2 plus 25. Now, what you don't want to do is you don't want the aircraft to accelerate past that airspeed. And the way you keep the airplane from accelerating past that airspeed is by balancing the amount of thrust that you have from your engines with your initial pitch angle. So if you pitch if your pitch angle is lower than it should be, then you're going to accelerate and you're going to overspeed the flaps because you have flaps up for takeoff. If you pull back too much, then you're going to bleed that engine off and your airspeed is going to start bleeding off and getting close or even below that V2 speed, and you don't want to do that. So the way you keep that airspeed balanced, that V2 plus 15 up to V2 plus 25, is with your pitch. And since the airplane, as Captain Jeff said, was very light and they were taken off with maybe not full power, but, you know, just some power, a lot of power, the only way to keep that airspeed balanced was with the pitch. And it looked pretty dramatic, but it certainly was not vertical.
And, of course, Go ahead.
I was going to say, I saw this clip for the first time while I was actually at the gym. One morning I did get up. But the girl who was on the treadmill next to me goes, ooh, wow. Wow. So,
yeah, that's what she said.
Exactly.
The chicks dig it.
That's what she said.
I love it. I'll have to do all my takeoffs like that. James continues, it's an excellent way to test certain things, including but not limited to tail strike avoidance, food cart locking mechanisms, passenger G tolerance, and indirectly the inventory of barf bags. So thank you, James, for that. It's always good to hear from James Keen.
You know, I think every time he leaves some feedback, I picture him just wearing sunglasses and very casually typing on his keyboard while
maybe
that song
a white
plays in the background.
White t-shirt.
Leather jacket. Yeah.
Jeans. Yeah. And a motorcycle.
Oh, and can I do another little point here? About the tail strike avoidance, fly-by-wire airplanes, the 777 and the 787, but they're both fly-by-wire. I don't know about the Airbuses. I never flew in Airbuses, but I know on the 777 at least that the fly-by-wire system is going to prevent you from doing a tail strike because the fly-by-wire system can tell the closure rate between the tail and the runway. And if it senses that the closure rate is too great or too big, the fly-by-wire system is actually going to reduce the sensibility of the elevator, and the elevator is actually going to be deflected less so that you get off the ground before the tail strikes the runway. So they've kind of thought of that as well.
Oh, this automation's got to protect these fallible pilots.
Yeah, it's pilot-proof airplane.
Well, that's a good point. Frick also sent an email regarding this YouTube video as well. So check it out. It's worth watching, that's for sure. Ahmad Danhamadou writes, and this is just a shout out to Arash, our website guru. He says, "Wow, Arash did a great job on this website. My hat and helmet goes off to him." So thank you, Arash, as always. We don't thank you enough for all the hard work that you do for making the APG website and community and all that kind of stuff operate so effectively and smoothly. So I do really appreciate all the work that you do. Let's see. Nick Carson writes, he said, "I just want to send this feedback to just express my personal thoughts of aviation." So I'm going to play a little bit of music in the background here. I'm going to probably have to turn down the volume a little bit on that. Okay, most people do not realize or appreciate how the invention of the airplane has changed most of society's means of transportation. It has become one of the most used modes of transportation for millions of people a year, with a small fraction of incidents compared to the number of flights. Sadly, flying seems to be more of an ordinary chore than the idea of flying once was more than 100 years ago. But every time I'm on an airplane flying high above the clouds, no matter where I'm heading off to, I'm always in awe that something of this weight and complexity can fly at hundreds of miles per hour for hours, carrying everything from passengers to cargo. I often think about how the change from the Wright brothers' basic aircraft that only flew for just a short amount of time and distance has changed to aircraft as big as the Airbus A380. It is because of this that I am grateful for having such a keen interest of this spectacular industry. And I know many share my interest as well. Thanks, and good day, Nick Carson." By the way, this is the United States Air Force Airmen of Note jazz band playing Fly Me to the Moon.
Excellent choice.
Yeah. So, Nick, thanks. You know what? I think that, Nick, you're expressing something that so many of the people that listen to this aviation-related podcast and others out there who aren't pilots but are so enthusiastic and passionate about flying. And we all understand that. We all get that. And we all feel the same way. But I appreciate you expressing it the way you did and sending in that that feedback. So thanks a lot, Nick. And as always, really appreciate your feedback. And Nick continues, by the way, Nick Carson, "Was wondering for you, Captain Jeff, what is the perfect flight length in your opinion? What about Miami Rick?" Well, I think that the length is not important.
That's what she said.
That's what she said. Oh, I was ready to go with it, too.
I don't really know what that means. So
I'm confused.
I know you are. Obviously, you are, because you're here with us today. Thank you. A little delayed there. Had to find it. I don't know if there is a perfect flight length, but obviously the kind of flying that I do is the shorter length flights. And I kind of like, if I'm flying anything more than 2.5-3 hours, it's like my bottom is getting a little sore, a little uncomfortable. And it's like time to stand up and move around. Of course, the thing is about these long range flights, you don't stay in that seat for 12 hours at a time. You actually get a chance to get up out of your seat and take a break. And so it's not like you're going to be sitting in that seat the entire time. Right, Rick?
Right. And I mean, the bulk of the flying that I do, is there are flights that are over 8 hours, some of them 12 hours, some of them more than 12 hours, up to 14 hours long. And just like Captain Jeff said, we're basically a two-man crew on flights that are up to and including 8 hours. Anything over 8 hours and up to 12 hours, we're a three-man crew. And anything over 12 hours is a four-man crew. And we switch around, and you're never in your seat for a very long, long period of time. Now, as far as what's the perfect length, the perfect flight length for me, I would say, because you have to keep in mind that when you take off, it usually takes about 30 to 35 minutes till you get to your cruise altitude, and then it takes about the same amount of time from the top of descent down to your landing, so it's about another 30 minutes. So you have an hour there. I like to have my lunch or my dinner or my breakfast and my cup of coffee or tea, at altitude, just looking out the window, just because it's just the best, just having your breakfast when the sun's coming up and you have that view out your window, and it just feels like you're suspended in animation. It's just outstanding. So I need about an hour to just kind of, just take that in, have my breakfast, have my coffee, and just think about all that stuff. So I would say that the perfect flight length for me would be in the 2.5 to 3 hour mark. I would say, anything more than that, it starts getting a little tiring. And interestingly enough, about 3 hours is the amount of time that we're at the airplane, at the control position of the airplane in the cockpit on these very, very long flights. So we kind of time it so you're never sitting down for more than 3 hours. So yeah, about 3 hours is the right length for me, I think.
Now for me, it's about an hour 15 to about an hour 45, something. it's shorter, and you get a chance to kind of take a breather and relax a little bit and think about things, and then you start your descent phase and your approach phase and everything else, and it just makes time move a lot faster. Of course, I'm not doing just one of those a day. I'm doing two or three of those.
That's a good point. I'm doing one flight and that is it. One 12, 13, 14 hour flight and that's it. Captain Jeff is doing, two or three sectors a day sometimes. So,
but there's, I used to fly longer range flights when I was flying the L-1011, especially the international version. And there's a lot to be said about that kind of flying as well. I used to say when I was in the Air Force, I'm a one takeoff, one landing kind of guy. Now, my ideal thing would be an hour and a half flight, one takeoff, one landing, and then crew rest kind of guy, but it's hard to find those kind of trips because, management usually wants you to be a little bit more productive than just a very short flight and then mostly layover time.
So I have a question for you, Captain Jeff. How about when you flew the L-1011 internationally and it was time for, time for a crew change, where would the crew member that was going on his break go? Did you guys have like a crew rest area or a business class seat that was basically cordoned off just for the crew, or how did it work?
Well, let me tell you, because I'm kind of old and I was flying the L-1011 and we had a three-man crew and we didn't have augmented crews. So we were in the seat the entire time. The entire
time. You get what you ask for here, Rick.
You young whippersnappers with your...
So, yeah, crew. That whole way of doing long-range flying these days is completely different because we had a captain and a first officer and a second officer, we didn't have any augmented crew. So we flew very long flights, and we stayed in the seat the whole time.
Wow.
Yeah.
That sounds very tiring.
Yeah.
Very tiring.
So, you know, things are a little bit different.
I remember
I was just thinking that sounds a lot less tiring than what I do on a daily basis, but we'll just leave that there.
It's interesting because I remember on the older 767s when I used to fly passengers, the crewrest area was actually in the economy section of the passenger cabin. And it was like a little room. It was basically like a little,
You said economy?
Yeah, economy, like a little cabin, like closed up. It looked like a lavatory, actually. And a lot of people actually thought it was a lavatory because it actually took a couple of rows of seats, maybe four or five rows of seats. It was kind of like a little, like, cubicle-looking thing. And people thought it was the lavatory. So, and then there were two bunk beds in there. And the interesting thing was it was really hard to get some sleep in there because people were constantly opening that darn door thinking that it was a lavatory. That was one thing. And then the other thing was that when you actually got some sleep, and a lot of these flights we would do during the daytime, we had, for example, a flight that was, we used to go from Santiago, Chile to Havana, Cuba, then from Havana to Cancun, and then Cancun to Miami. And this was a daytime flight. And obviously the first guy to go to sleep was the FO, right? So, you know, back in my FO days, I'd go into sleep, I'd stuff myself in that little room back there and try to get some sleep. And sometimes I would. And I would, when it was my time to go back, they would ring you on the interphone on the flight deck interphone. There was a little interphone in there. You'd pick up the phone, a little groggy, like, "Is it my time to go back to work?" And then the captain would be like, "Yep, you got to come on back." So you have to get out of this little room there, open the door, and as you open the door, the entire economy section is looking at you. And you're coming out of that little room with your shirt untucked, your eyes are a little red, your hair is all over the place, your tie is all over the place. So
guy's going to be flying the airplane now.
And you're going to fly this plane now? Are you our pilot?
It was interesting. I have another funny story. One time, a captain, a very, very senior captain, he's now retired. He was the last guy to go to sleep, I guess, to go on his rest period. And then they landed, and everybody forgot about the guy. All the passengers got off the airplane, and they moved the airplane from the terminal to the maintenance area. They switched the power off, and then the guy is still in there. and then the guy wakes up, I don't know how many hours later. And he's like, "Where am I? What's going on? It's all stuffy and hot in there." He goes to the flight deck. He realizes that there's no air stairs. There's nothing. So he actually had to turn on the battery, get on the radio, and talk to operations so that they could come up to the airplane, put a ladder up to the airplane, and get him and let him off the airplane. The funny thing was that for the longest time, they were like, who's calling us? Who is this guy? Is he?
It's a crank caller.
They just forgot about him.
Yeah, they really did forget. I always wondered if they did that on purpose or not.
Yeah, I wonder.
But just imagine, it's one of those famous stories back in the airline. So funny. Poor guy.
Oh, well. Bless his heart. Okay. Moving on. Great stories, by the way. Thank you, Rick.
Yeah.
Alex from Ottawa says, "I'm currently working during the summer with Transport Canada, the Canadian FAA, with their Civil Aviation Protection Group. So we look over research and implementation of new technologies such as biojet fuel." Ooh, biojet fuel. That's a green technology.
That's definitely green technology.
A 100 low-level or low-lead unleaded replacement noise reduction, etc. So you know what that means. Oh, we're going green. So, sorry, I couldn't resist. Now,
we're gonna take care of the earth. We're going green.
So now I'm going to be hearing that song for the rest of the week. Yes, you are. And yep. Everybody else that listens to this show. I just wanted to ask you a couple of questions. I was looking through some airport charts, especially KATL and CYYZ, Toronto. And there are some markings that they call ILS holding and CAT 1 and CAT 2 hold. I don't know if these are similar type of markings and what is their purpose, as they are way before the normal holding short lines before the runway. I also wanted to ask you if there is any important differences between a normal ILS approach and an ILS PRM approach, such as the ones that you use at your home airport, or ILS and GLS approaches, like the ones they use at Houston Intercontinental and Newark. And so he says, I hope everything's going well with you and your family. Thanks for doing the best podcast in the internet. Ooh, thank you. And let's see.
There you go.
Keep it up. Please let me know if you have any questions with the green technology or anything regarding the science behind propulsion, as I am studying aerospace engineering. Ooh. Okay, well, keep that in mind. Thank you, Alex. Okay, so going back to the first question you asked regarding the ILS holding Category 1, Category 2, Category 3 holding lines. And essentially, you know, if you're using the instrument landing system technology, they're using electronic beams or electronic signals to give us guidance information for lateral and vertical guidance, you know, glide slope guidance and lateral or track guidance to the runway. And anytime you, especially when you're doing a Category 2 and Category 3 approach, because of the much lower ceiling and visibility requirements of those approaches, it's very important that you keep airplanes and vehicles and anything that could possibly interfere with the signal or bend the signal from approaching that area, so that that signal is kind of pure. And basically, when there are those kind of approaches in effect and you're taxiing out to a runway, the air traffic control, the ground control, will tell you to hold short of the Category 2 or Category 3 ILS line instead of proceeding all the way up to the runway, because they are protecting that area. And in general, anytime the weather is below 800 feet ceiling and two miles visibility, they will protect those areas for those type of approaches. I believe that's the number, 802?
Yep.
Does that sound familiar? Okay. So that's why we have those separate lines that are kind of quite a ways away from the normal hold lines for the runway. And any of us who have flown airplanes and ILS approaches and during normal conditions, when you're flying in, you'll notice that sometimes your localizer signal and your glide slope signal will kind of give you kind of weird signals, and it'll be bouncing around, etc. And it's not so critical when you're doing a Category 1 approach. So that is the deal with the holding short lines. And the differences between the ILS approaches and ILS PRM. PRM stands for precision monitoring approach, where they have
precision runway monitoring.
Right.
Yep. Yeah.
Runway or radar?
Yeah, precision
runway. Radar. Runway monitoring.
Runway.
Okay. Yeah, anyway, they have a very sensitive radar that they use. So normally a radar is going like all the way around 360 degrees. When they're using the PRM radar, it's like a very, very tight little sweep that goes back and forth in a very narrow distance. And it updates very, very quickly, so they can keep track of the airplanes coming in. And this is usually when you're doing simultaneous, like two or three simultaneous precision approaches at one time. And it usually is when the visibility and ceiling is lower than normal, and they can kind of see what trends are going on with airplanes tracking and et cetera. And it requires special training and qualification to do the approaches, both for the pilots and for the air traffic controllers. And it also requires special equipment, and we also monitor. We have two radios. Normally, the second radio is used for monitoring, you know, guard frequency or monitoring a company frequency. But when we're doing precision runway monitor approaches, PRM approaches, we will actually tune that to a discrete frequency that is a person who is monitoring that frequency constantly in case there is any kind of encroachment upon that protected area of your approach. And then when they sense that there is some kind of a encroachment upon your safe zone, they will let you know, and they'll tell you to, you know, fly a certain heading and descend to a certain altitude to keep the separation, you know, from other airplanes. So you're listening to a couple different frequencies at the same time, and you have to, if that happens, if they tell you to maintain an altitude and fly a certain heading, then you have to turn off the autopilot and turn off the flight director system and hand fly the airplane. And the reason for that is they want you to do these actions as quickly as possible to ensure separation and safe operation. So finally, let's see, Alex from Ottawa asked about the ILS versus GLS approach. I can't really talk a lot about that myself because we don't have that capability in the Mad Dog that I fly at Acme. But the GLS is basically a system that utilizes satellite technology, the GBAS system, which is ground-based augmentation system, and it kind of uses that into a landing system kind of a situation.
And right. You need to have for this kind of approach. You need to have your required navigational performance is very, very, you need to like your R&P and your actual navigational performance, it has to be spot on, because you're basically relying solely on the wide area augmentation system to provide you with both your lateral guidance, or what would be your localizer, runway lineup, and your vertical guidance, what would be your glide slope down to the runway. And I was telling Captain Jeff and Dr. Steph here a second ago that here in Miami, we do a procedure very often, actually, when the ILS for runway 9, which is the runway that we operate into most of the time, when that ILS is written up or NOTAMed up or basically not working, we'll do that approach. It's called an LPV, which is a localizer performance with vertical guidance. And basically, it's just like you were flying an ILS. You know, it basically lines you up with the runway. It has a 3-degree glide all the way down to a 50-foot height over the threshold, which will put you right on the touchdown zone of the runway. And the minimums for that approach are 200 feet, just like the ILS is. So it's very, very accurate, very spot on. And you can fly it automatic on autopilot all the way down to minimums. So it's very accurate, really, really cool.
And so that uses basically the satellite network instead of the ground-based electronic ILS guidance.
Right.
Interesting. Well, that's the feature, isn't it?
Oh, yeah.
All right. Have any experience with that, Stephanie, those kind of approaches?
Well, if you're using one of the, like the Garmin G430, you'll fly basically the same thing. If you're flying an RNAV approach, it's LPV. So same thing as what Rick just described. So.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Excellent.
It's interesting. It's interesting because the you'll have there's difference in what's called a straight in minima. Your basic ground based approach, like an ILS or a VOR or an old school NDB, you'll have what are called straight in minima anywhere between within a 30-degree arc around that runway. That anything within that 30-degree arc, it's straight in. On these GPS approaches, because they need to be very, very accurate, you only have straight in minima within 15 degrees of that approach arc. So anything outside of that is circle to land minima. And in a lot of airports, you can't do circle to land because of obstacles or, you know, high terrain or stuff like that. So
right. Yep.
Very interesting. Well, yeah, thank you, Alex from Ottawa, for those great questions. Hopefully we answered all to your satisfaction. Rodney writes, I have some feedback for Jack in Britain. Remember that Jack a few episodes ago was talking about going to the west coast of California, flying out of Long Beach for getting some flight training. And he was looking for some suggestions from APG community members. And he said he has never flown out to the west coast himself, but it is his normal stomping ground in flight Flight Simulator X. And there's an excellent ATC service there provided by Pilot Edge. Anyway, two airports I suggest Jack should visit would be Big Bear in the mountains and Catalina Island, KAVX. It is suggested for first-time pilots into Catalina that you fly an experienced pilot with an experienced pilot, as it is a bit tricky. Catalina, I can tell you, is a very beautiful island, and it's a cool place to visit, whether you fly in or you take the boat. Highly recommended by Captain Jeff, but I've never flown into Catalina Island Airport, but there are some suggestions for you, Jack, and I guess we should continue with one that I had skipped, but Stephanie is complaining because she actually did some research on this, so I'm going to go back to it. Randy Fields writes, he sends in an article here in the IndieChannel.com about a gentleman, a French person, who was flying, I think, from Las Vegas to somewhere in France, and in flight he had a heart attack at 40,000 feet. And he said, I thought I would forward this story to you. It made the local news. And so basically the article talks about the in-flight defibrillator. Is that what those things are called?
Steph? Yeah, a defibrillator. So an AED is an automated external defibrillator, which was used in this case, it sounds like. I did listen to the... So if you click on the link to the story, it actually takes you to a video of it. And I watched the video yesterday, so I'm not recalling all of the details of it, but I think they did use the AED in that case. So, but I was just going to go into a little bit about, I don't know how many, you know, this is like, as a physician, you get on an airline flight and, you know, I know a lot of my colleagues kind of dread that question. Is there a doctor on board? and it's happened to a couple friends of mine. It's never happened to me. I've never been asked or had my services called upon for that. But I know you've talked about it in the past where, you know, basically what the protocol is, and if there's a medical emergency, you all are notified about that by the flight attendants, and there's a service that you use that helps in the decision-making process of what's going to happen, whether you need to divert or whether you can continue, or, you know, if anything should be done during that medical issue. I don't know if you have anything to add to this before I launch into a whole bunch of stuff.
That is exactly right, yes.
Yeah. But basically, you know, so this gentleman had a heart attack mid-flight. So I went back and did some looking to think, you know, gosh, there's all kinds of things, medical emergencies that could happen in flight. And I came across this article from the New England Journal of Medicine. It was back in 2013. And basically what they did was they reviewed records looking at calls to a medical communication center, so one of those services, from five domestic and international airlines between 2008 and 2010. And they looked at, you know, what type of event was it, what happened, what kind of air, you know, where were they going, origin, destination, the availability of onboard assistance, what types of medications they used or other medical equipment. And basically what it comes down to, the things I wanted to say about this. So for that period of time that they were looking at in this study, there were basically 744 million airline passengers during that study period on these airlines that they looked at. And there were 11,920 in-flight medical emergencies. So that's a rate of 16 medical emergencies per 1 million passengers. So not a terribly small number. I mean, that's still a fair amount. The most common medical problems were syncope or presyncope. So basically, someone passing out or feeling like they're going to pass out. Respiratory symptoms was number two at 12.1%. Nausea and vomiting. And it says basically so of those 11,920 cases, only 875 of the flights were diverted. So every other flight landed at their scheduled destination. So only 7% of those emergencies ended up needing to be diverted. Not a very large percentage at all. And the other thing I was going to bring up, so basically it talks about what types of providers were on board. So physicians provided assistance in 48% of the cases, nurses in 20%, EMS providers in 4%, and some sort of other health professional, I guess, in 3.7%. AEDs, the automated external defibrillators, were only used in 137 patients, so it's only 1%. And the chief symptoms there were people feeling like they were going to pass out, complaining of chest pain, or some patients who had loss of consciousness. So, and only 24 cases were actually cardiac arrest or a heart attack. So not very common to have a heart attack or a cardiac arrest on a flight.
What's interesting to me is that it seems I would just have figured that more nurses would have been involved in these events than doctors, because it seems like there are a lot more nurses than doctors.
Yeah, you know, you think there would be, but apparently it was only, what did I say? So it was almost a 2-to-1 ratio. So physicians were 48% and nurses were 20% of people who responded.
The other question I have, Dr. Steph, is that is there any liability that you have to think about here?
Well, everything falls under the Good Samaritan laws. So basically, if you're acting within good faith and not outside of your, I guess, outside of your scope of practice, you know, if you're basically providing basic life support services, that applies to almost, you know, all medical personnel receive some sort of basic life support training. So if you're just doing that type of stuff, you're going to be protected by Good Samaritan laws, as long as you're not grossly negligent and trying to do something untoward towards that patient. So,
because I know one of the problems with being a physician is all the malpractice, lawsuits.
Sure, sure.
And insurance.
And I mean, that's different. That applies to, you know, if a patient comes seeking your services versus you're having to be a bystander and offer your assistance in an emergency situation. So,
interesting.
Good Samaritan laws are a little bit different there, but as long as you're acting in good faith and within your scope of practice, then no matter what the outcome is, it's not going to harm you in any way to provide assistance.
Well, that's good to know.
Yeah. But I also came across, and I think I can read this because it's on the FAA's website, about the type of medical or emergency medical equipment that's required to be carried on airliners. I don't know. Have you gone into this in the past? I can't remember for certain.
Not really, no.
Okay. So there's actually a whole list, and this is part of an advisory circular, of what emergency medical equipment should be carried on commercial air carriers. So basically, you need to have a blood pressure cuff, a stethoscope, airways, so something that's going to open the airway. It's usually a little plastic device that's inserted back behind the tongue. You need it in 3 sizes, a pediatric, a small adult, and a large adult. You need a self-inflating manual resuscitation device. So those are those bags that, you know, you see on medical dramas where they're squeezing the bag and it's inflating and they're doing it to for respiratory purposes. CPR mask in 3 sizes again, an IV administration set with tubing with 2 Y connectors, alcohol sponges, adhesive tape, tape scissors, a tourniquet, 500 cc's of saline solution, non-permeable gloves. You need a variety of needles, so or sizes as necessary to administer required medications. Syringes, they recommend 1 5cc, 2 10cc's, or sizes necessary. Non-narcotic analgesics, an antihistamine tablet for allergic reactions, an antihistamine injectable, atropine. So some of these are for, some of these medications that they're going to get into right now are for advanced cardiac life support. So really should not be administered by anyone unless they have training for ACLS protocol. So things like atropine, epinephrine, lidocaine, those are all medications that you're going to use if you recognize certain cardiac arrhythmias or asystole or ventricular tachycardia, all kinds of bad things in cardiac situations. Aspirin, a bronchodilator, so if someone's having an asthma attack. Dextrose for diabetics. Nitroglycerin tablets for people who are having chest pain. And then this is my favorite, basic instructions for the use of drugs in the kit. So they're going to give you some sort of guidelines for how to use these medications in case you have never heard of atropine or epinephrine or, yeah. Sorry.
No, I figured this is the first time I've had to use that for Dr. Steph.
I got very excited about this question. So,
That's really interesting stuff, though, because I mean, from the point of view of a pilot, I'm just trying to get the airplane on the ground as quickly as possible. And I remember talking to Dr. Steph and Captain Jeff about this, and mentioning how I remember one time I had one of the flight attendants in the back tell me that a passenger I remember this was on a flight to New York. And maybe a Beam Dixon over in North Carolina there, the old Dixon NDB, mm-hmm. 198 kilohertz, I'll never forget. We got a call from the back saying that apparently a gentleman was not feeling very well. And so we went on with our procedure, you know, requesting the assistance of a doctor and then calling the medical service via the SATCOM and all that stuff. And apparently, yes, the guy was in cardiac arrest. And We didn't really hear about the fact that he was really in a cardiac arrest, because I really don't know how it works, Dr. Steph. I guess the situation basically got progressively worse to the point where the guy was in cardiac arrest, and then when we realized that he was, we were near the top of descent going into John F. Kennedy Airport. And I remember, man, I got that airplane down so fast. I was telling Captain Jeff that the only time I've ever flown, you know, above 330 knots in the JFK traffic management area, you know, below 1,000 feet, which is unheard of, because they're over in New York, anybody that flies up there, they know that they're very strict with speed restrictions and altitude mm-hmm. restrictions and all kinds of, you know, because there's just the volume of traffic is so great up there that, you know, you have to do what they tell you to do right away, otherwise they'll take you out of the queue and they'll put you in the back, and then you don't want that to happen to you, because you're usually pretty low on fuel by the time you get there and all that stuff. So we got down so fast, we landed, got off the runway, got to the terminal, and then I requested the passengers over the PA to stay in their seats, because we basically had to have EMTs get on the airplane and get to the aft galley, which is where this guy was just laying down there, and he landed that way back there because they couldn't bring him back to the seat. And basically took him, you know, this is on the 7-6, which is not a small airplane, as Dr. Steph knows, you know.
Yeah, I'm type rated.
after her type rating over at IAD. So they basically have to walk all the way back to the airplane and get him out of there. And the guy eventually, he was all right. He, you know, he recouped completely. And we actually, I remember, I don't think I mentioned this, we actually got a thank you letter from him saying that, you know, we did, you know, what we did. And he was really thankful for all that stuff. But looking at it from a pilot point of view, I had no idea that so much goes into this kind of situation. You know, you're from our side of the cockpit door, you're thinking about, let's get this thing on the ground as quick as possible, because this guy may very well die. And that's a whole other kind of worms that, oh goodness, I mean, that's a story for another show. But I've actually had passengers pass away on a flight, and that is just something that you want to avoid at all costs, because it's just something that, and even more so if it happens over another country. So get the airplane down on the ground as quickly as possible and deal with it, as best you can, really.
Yep. Well, and this was good information for me to look up too, because like I said, a fair number of my friends who are physicians and doctors have been on planes and have gotten that overhead call, hey, is there a doctor on board? So it's good to know what the required contents are of that emergency medical kit. And apparently some airlines actually have or offer enhanced kits, and they have a whole host of other drugs that might be available as well. So
yep.
Including some unusual things like antipsychotics and naloxone, which is Narcan for narcotic overdoses and things like that. So
yeah, we have
all kinds of stuff. So
yeah, wow.
Good for me to know. This was educational for me too. So
cool, education for all of us.
Yeah. Absolutely, thanks, Dr. Steph. That was really cool. Really, and never mind the crickets. You've joined a very select club. There's only two of us in that club. So
only because we don't have crickets to play back to Captain Jeff.
That's and what I'm saying. Let's keep it that way.
I'm gonna get a soundboard one of these days.
Okay, Doug, my Annie, and I figured out how to pronounce his name, even though he always gives me what is that called?
The phonetic.
Phonetic spelling of how to pronounce his name. I'm just going to think Miami, but I'm going to say my Annie.
There you go.
Yeah. Okay. Is my neighbor to the northwest in Woodstock. Yes, I did skip another one, Dr. Steph, and I'm doing that on purpose.
Okay.
I saw this sure. little tidbit regarding we're having this behind-the-scenes communication going on here, just to let you know. I saw this little tidbit regarding a possible new Boeing airliner on Twitter today, and I thought you and your partners in crime might find it interesting. Fascinating that this design is predicated on more powerful turbofan engines that don't even exist yet. I love to see technology advancing every year, and I believe aviation has done much to stimulate creative thinking. So we'll put that little tidbit in the show notes. But on to a quick question for you and Rick on route wind forecasting. Do you both update the winds along your FMC flight plan during the flight? As a PC-based simulator enthusiast, Lockheed Martin Prepare 3D, I fly both the 737 NGX and the Boeing 772 most frequently. On the Boeing 772 FMC in my simulator, the legs/route data page is populated with route winds during initial loading of the flight plan. Is it normal to update the winds again during the flight? If that's true, how often are they pushed to you from the dispatcher via ACARS? So, what do you think?
Well, it's interesting because the winds aloft is a very critical part of your flight planning, because your winds aloft basically are going to determine your fuel burn, because geographically you might be X miles away from your destination. But when you take into account the winds that you might have against you or for you, that distance might be shorter or longer, or the flight time might be shorter or longer. So you have to put that in there. You have to calculate that or factor that into your flight planning. Now, during the pre-flight, after we get the flight plan from operations, we load it up on the flight management computer via ACARS. And then just as you said here, on the route data page of the legs page there, you request the winds. But before you request the winds, you're going to put down your initial flight level on the lower left prompt there. You're going to be able to put down your flight level and the temperature at your what's called the top of climb, which is the first point at which you level off during your initial climb out. You have, let me think here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 lines where you can put altitudes and select altitudes for winds. Usually what I do is I'll request the winds aloft for the first altitude on the flight plan. I'll request the winds aloft for the level 2,000 feet below that, and then 2,000 feet above my initial flight level, and then 2,000 feet above that. Why 2,000 feet? Because unlike highways, when you're driving on the street, when you have airplanes flying along the same airway, you have an airplane going north and another airplane going south. One airplane might be flying on an even flight level, and the airplane going the other way is flying on an odd flight level. So that's why you have to request winds aloft every 2,000 feet. Now, do I update the winds aloft? Absolutely, because when we do what's called a step climb, which is the point at which the weight of the airplane goes down far enough to where you are able to climb to a higher altitude to optimize your fuel burn, you no longer need the information from the winds aloft that are below you. So what I'll do is I will keep the flight level from which I just climbed at the bottom, and then I'll request the next level up that I didn't have before. I don't know if I'm explaining myself correctly here. Now, winds aloft come out every 6 hours. So there's basically 4 reports a day. And not only do you get winds, but you also get temperature above aloft. And those are parameters that the flight management computer uses to calculate your fuel burn and your optimum, what's called recommended flight level. Your recommended flight level is the flight level that the optimum flight level, which is the flight level that you should be at, only taking into account your weight. Your recommended flight level is your optimum flight level, taking into account the winds aloft calculation as well. So that's how we do it.
Yeah. So basically, you know, as the critical thing I heard from that is that these wind forecasts are only updated 4 times a day, every 6 hours. So you know, on a typical flight that I do, you know, there's, I don't update the winds because the forecast winds that I have are not going to change from, you know, what the original forecast that I had. And once the airplane is airborne, it actually uses the actual wind that it's receiving from its calculations to, and then the forecast winds ahead as well.
Right, but for the airplane to see if it's worth, if it's worth it for you to actually do a step climb, it needs to know what the wind is above you.
Right.
Or sometimes you'll do a step descent if the winds are better below you. And
sure.
So the FMC needs to have those winds loaded in there so that it can compare whether it's better above or below.
But I mean, how many times when you're flying along, Rick, that do you receive a message from the company, we have the new updated forecast winds in, and then you receive all that data and then you put that into your flight plan or your FMC?
I mean, not very often, but like I said, I'll update the winds whenever I do a step climb. And if I see, like, for example, if I know that I'm not going to climb above 36,000 feet, just as an example, I'm not going to request winds for flight level 400 because I know I'm not going to get there.
Mm-hmm.
But I will request the winds for flight level 380. Now, if I know that I'm not going to get to flight level 380 and I already have the winds for flight level 360, I won't request the winds again. I'm talking about very, very long flights where step climbing is actually something that is going to help you burn less fuel and get there quicker.
And who are you requesting these winds from?
The company via ACARS.
Okay.
And they'll send it to your computer, to your flight management computer. You load them and then you execute them, which is something else that we talked about a couple episodes ago.
Right.
It's not like you get a message and it's automatically executed into your flight management computer or your route page. You have to first load it, check it, and then execute it
Do you not already have that data with you before you take off?
Yeah, you do. You do.
Okay.
But it's interesting because on these very, very long flights, I'm talking, you know, 12, 13, 14 hour long flights. Sometimes you won't get for some reason, I don't know what's going on there behind the scenes. For some reason, maybe just equipment problems. For some reason, you won't get the wind uplink from the company. And you'll actually have to go and put every wind down. And you have to think about that some of these very, very long flights have upwards of 9 or 10 pages, leg pages, mm-hmm. and each has 5 lines. So you're talking about 50 points, and each point has 5 levels. So you're there forever, and it never fails that by the time you're done, the second you're done, the uplink happens, and you're like, oh.
Yeah, so we don't really have uplinks at all in my airplane. It's all manual. So we receive the flight plan. It has the winds, and, you know, you put in the winds for your anticipated cruise level, and, you know, you work with that. But honestly, my flights are so short that it doesn't make a huge or significant difference.
Yeah.
So, interesting. Good question, Doug, about winds. I hope that answered it. And we'll continue with a piece of feedback from Grant in Australia. It is from Grant McCarran. SouthernSkiesMedia.com. All right, good. Playing Crazy Down Under, and is a balloonist. And remember that episode we were talking about, flying songs and that kind of thing. And I did the up, up, and away.
Yep.
For Grant. Okay. Not sure about the older aircraft, such as the ones the recent publicity-seeking consultant was claiming to have hacked. But there was some concern a while back with the 787 using the same network for both IFE and for aircraft systems. This design decision was made in order to save weight on cabling and share access to the internet via the same antenna, etc. Access from the cabin via the IFE is protected via a firewall, which is concerning, as I've yet to meet a firewall that was perfectly secure. That's true. So far, I have not seen anything to say that Boeing has introduced an air gap to separate the systems. The only truly reliable method of protecting systems from each other is to prevent them talking in the first place. I doubt we'll hear anything from the airframers, as they seem to be taking a, quote, security through obscurity approach. More details can be found, including links to reports below. And he says, thanks again for your show. I remember you've always got tailwinds when you're flying a balloon. That's true. let's see, he continues on. I know that on the 787, there was some talk in the past in 2008 about how the IFE and avionics systems were on a shared network to save cost and weight. Let's see. Let me scroll down here. There is a link to an article regarding a cyber attack concerns raised over Boeing 787 chip's back door. Two Cambridge experts have discovered a backdoor in a computer chip used in military systems and aircraft such as the Boeing 787 that could allow the chip to be taken over via the internet. The discovery will heighten concerns about the risks of cyber attacks on sensitive installations, coming on the heels of the discovery this week of the Flamer virus, which has been attacking computer systems in Iran, Syria, and Saudi Arabia. So basically, the article is talking about, I'll have a link to it in the show notes, the chip made by Actel, the Pro ASIC 3, is used in medical, automotive, communications, and consumer products, and military use. And apparently there is some kind of a back door here where people can get in and, access the chip and change the way it behaves. And they talked about the fact that it was used in the Boeing 787 Dreamliner. So, yeah, maybe this is a valid concern. And I don't know enough about this kind of stuff because I'm not an IT guy, especially when it comes to chips used in modern airplanes. I know that I'm safe on my Mad Dog because there is nothing this fancy and modern in it, but the 787s, 777s, Airbus 350s, et cetera, and future airplanes, I'm hoping that, somebody out there, the software engineers, have been thinking about this capability and have closed that security loophole.
Yeah, absolutely. I think it'll be all right. Mad Dog is it's a pretty manual. It is fly by wire though. It's cable wire.
Exactly. Okay. Well, thank you, Grant, for sending that. Yeah, you're right. I don't mean to dismiss. And maybe it's just because I think, well, how could anybody be stupid enough to not have some kind of an air gap or separation between systems like IFE, in-flight entertainment systems, and systems that are critical to flying an airplane, and how could they not separate them? But
Well, I guess it's one of those things that unless you're thinking that it could be a problem, why? If it makes sense to link them together somehow to save somewhere else for cost and weight, maybe that's all you're thinking of at the time the system is designed.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I could see where that would happen.
I could too. But now it's a different world, I guess, we're living in. And people are probably going, maybe that was not a good idea.
In hindsight, yes, maybe we need to go back and change how things are wired.
Maybe that's why.
You got 17-year-olds starting helicopters nowadays.
Lord. And maybe that's
why. What is the world coming to?
Maybe that's why we haven't heard anybody from Boeing or Airbus saying, no, you can't do that with our systems. They've been suspiciously quiet. I hope that's not the case, because that makes me sad. Let's see here. This is Hendrik, a longtime listener from Berlin. I love the show and enjoy every episode. I like the episodes with Dr. Steph and Miami Rick. They add a very entertaining dynamic to the show. Okay.
Thank you.
Seems like you've been doing the show in this setup for years. Here's my two-part feedback. Both mentioned in episode 170. Regarding American Airlines A321 range, he visited the Airbus factory in Hamburg a few months ago. He says, highly recommended for every aviation geek. The guide mentioned and actually showed us one of the American A321s. Apparently, they get an extra or extended center fuel tank so that they can perform the missions that American uses to fly or used to fly with the 757s. Okay, that answers that question. Regarding the listener from the UK that asked about information regarding flying at/from KLGB Long Beach, I did the same thing as he intends to do last year. I collected some flying hours by flying around the U.S. West Coast. I also started in Long Beach. It's a great choice to get some experience. He said, I created a travel blog. It's in German, though. And then he has a link for that. I'll include that in the show notes in case you can read German. The Los Angeles airspace is a bit intimidating for a general aviation pilot at first, but once you get used to it, it's actually pretty easy to get around. ATC is very helpful. Don't be afraid to talk to them. Feel free to send my email address to the listener so that he can get in contact with me and ask for more specific info if he wants. I'm happy to help. I'm not sure if I did that or not, Hendrik, but I'll try to remember to do that. Thank you very much. Okay, so that's from Hendrik. Thank you very much for that feedback from Berlin.
Thank you, Hendrik. Yep.
And do we have time for another audio feedback from Vlad? I think we do.
Sure, why not?
Let's hear from Controller Vlad in Moscow.
Hello there, Captain Jeff. My name is Rick, Dr. Steph. Hope you're all listening. Controller Vlad here from Moscow, Russia. I've been listening to one of the recent episodes where you were discussing that CPDLC thing, the controller pilot data link communication, basically the text messages exchange feature between ATCs and pilots. And I know how skeptical you are about it, that it cannot replace the radio, that it may be confusing and even dangerous in some situation, blah blah blah. So yes, I agree with you for the most part. This relatively new technology is somewhat not as trustworthy or reliable as the everyday voice communication, and that's completely understandable. But let me share my take on this. I don't think it's designed to replace the radio completely, but to become an alternative or a backup. It also may lower the workload on an ATCO and actually increase the effectiveness and timing of issuing the clearances and instructions. Not necessarily should it be used in critical instances like clearing the takeoff or changing the flight level when a mistake is unacceptable. I should probably mention that we don't have it here in Russia yet, and I don't have experience using it. So I'll be talking about a fictional, but still pretty much everyday situation, and how could the CPDLC fit into it. Let's pretend that a controller on duty has 20 aircraft on his frequency. 10 of them are about to leave the sector. 5 of them are expecting descent shortly, and the rest is just cruising, flying by. And as it often happens, there are periods when you have a lot of traffic, but it's not the time to give instructions yet. And when it is time, you need to speak to several stations simultaneously. And I know some may say there are things and phrases like, for example, overpoint, so-and-so, contact, so-and-so, unit, frequency, and, I don't know, when ready, descent to flight level, blah, blah, blah. Yes, these things help us to save time, but not always they are appropriate for different reasons. And to be honest, there are times when you speak non-stop, like a radio DJ or something. I'm sure all of you have listened to liveatc.net. So 10 aircraft need to be given a frequency change and 5 other to be cleared to descend. So it's hard to tell which is more important, to prevent the unwanted descent profile or to let some airplanes enter an adjacent sector but still be on wrong frequency. Anyhow, both things will happen because passing the message takes time, so does the readback. That's where that quote, ridiculous, unquote, CPDLC thing could help the controller out. Let's say he or she has sets of standard instructions to change frequency composed beforehand and has the possibility to just copy-paste and send them in just a couple of clicks of a mouse and receive a visual confirmation in a data block next to the radar target. It will take considerably less time than calling every single aircraft separately, and even can be done while speaking to other crew. And I'm begging the listeners not to underestimate the multitasking skills of both pilots and controllers, and think that it's not safe or something. It happens all the time. You do one thing, speak another, and think of a third. It's the essence of our jobs. So, what is the outcome? All instructions were given in time. Everyone is in contact with the appropriate controller, and those who needed to start their descent are doing so. Everybody's happy, and the safety was never compromised. This is just a from-the-top-of-my-head situation. There are plenty of other you can think of. But my idea is CPDLC should be used in routine standard cases when it may save time and even reduce the confusion in pronunciation numbers or words. It may even help with the stuck mic thing, as not always 1 to 1.5 allows you to reach the blocking station. Well, I hope you guys find any of these reasonable. The amount of traffic will continue to increase, and text messaging between pilots and controllers will somewhat help dealing with it. So let me thank you for your great podcast, and also all the other listeners for every very educational and sometimes even inspiring feedback. Looking forward to upcoming episodes. Take care, guys. Fly safe.
Thank you, Vlad, from Moscow, for taking the time out. It's just awesome to know these people are all around the world listening to the show and participating in it. And you make a lot of good points. And, you know, I guess my concern about data link communications is that it's used to replace absolutely everything. And as we've mentioned in previous episodes, that our concern is, using it for takeoff clearances and landing clearances and dynamic situations such as airport operations.
Like time critical commands or requirements.
But for what you're talking about, all the examples that you gave were excellent examples, I think, for implementing a system such as that, where you have canned instructions and canned responses and that kind of thing, but not something that's going to require there's a truck on the runway, the guy is on short final, you have to tell him to go around. Obviously, you can't just quickly type in that, and you can't, as a pilot, cognitively understand what the message is and respond to it in a quick enough manner, I think.
Right.
Yeah, exactly. Well, I think you had mentioned before, for things like clearance delivery or stuff that's not where you're not building a mental picture of what's going on around you. And like you mentioned, the time critical stuff, then that's fine. And it probably should be used there because it's going to, not tie up the frequencies for other more important stuff.
Right.
Right. And interestingly enough, a lot of these, well, actually most of the messages that you send out via CPDLC on your lower ICAS there, they're basically just pre-formatted. All you're doing is you're just filling in the spots where you'd put in the variables, the requested altitudes, or, where you're flying out of, where you're flying to, your ATIS information, where you're parked. And then you just fill all those little blocks in there and just basically press send. And it's a pre-formatted message. But you do have a page that says, and the name of the page is free text, where you would just write down whatever you want to write down and send it via CPDLC. But just like we said, not on time critical issues.
Exactly.
Yep.
Well, thank you very much for your feedback, Vlad. And again, thank you for listening and participating in the show. And finally, before we sign off, I know we've been going for quite a long time. We're not sure exactly how long, because we've started and stopped several times here. But I'd like to mention this, and this is just a reminder to those of you out there who sometimes throw out some of the rules out the window because you think that you're stunned by celebrity or whatever, and you're just not thinking straight. Maybe your brain is getting inputs from other areas that it shouldn't, and you're not thinking clearly. Did you hear about this Argentine situation where there was a Playboy model that they invited up to fly the airplane, and apparently the Argentine pilots didn't realize that she was taking video of everything and recording it, and then she took the further step by putting it out there on social media. And nice. We've talked about social media in the past.
I can't imagine what would possess you to do something as
stupid as that, and have her manipulate the throttles for the takeoff, and have her, you know, talk on the short final while they're, you know, obviously you're supposed to be concentrating on landing the aircraft, getting back on the ground safely. I mean, and it's not the first time it's happened. I remember maybe last year or 2 years ago, a Mexican airline did the same, and they actually sat down the girl on the captain's seat in mid-flight, and she took pictures. And obviously, what do you do with those? You put them on Facebook.
Yeah, this is the world. And,
come on,
the world we live in. You know, if somebody's up there, they're going, and they have a camera with them or a phone with them. You gotta be careful. And this Argentine airline, Australinas Aéreas. How do you pronounce that? Is that right?
Líneas Aéreas Austral, and that's kind of like the feeder airline for Aerolíneas Argentinas, which is the big national airline from Argentina. So Austral, okay, is kind of like they fly a lot of the, you know, Ember 175 type aircraft. So it's like the small feeders, and
yeah, then, like a regional airline or whatever.
Exactly. There you go. Yep.
Well, they announced that it has terminated two of their pilots after they invited model Victoria Zikpolit. Dakis, I don't know, I think she's Greek maybe, into the cockpit, allowed her to fly the plane, including during takeoff. She's best known for appearing on Argentine TV shows, as well as in the Greek version of Playboy magazine. The incident occurred Monday of this week, while on board flight 2708 from Buenos Aires to Rosario, Argentina. During her experience in the cockpit, she took selfies, recorded videos, operated the throttles on the ERJ-190's twin engines. And let's see, pilots Patricio Zocchi Molina and Federico Matias Soage, I don't know how you pronounce S-O-A-J-E.
Oh, you got it.
Were named in the statement as having been terminated, as well as the rest of the staff with responsibility in this event. And of course, she went on and, you know, was saying how incredibly sorry she was for all this and everything else. But come on, you got to use common sense, people.
Well, I mean, wasn't entirely smart on her part, but I don't think she's the one to blame here.
No, so, she should never have been allowed to do any of that.
Yeah.
It's definitely the pilot's fault. I mean, they endangered the safety of the operation of the flight, safety of the passengers. And wow. You think that everybody has common sense, but apparently not. So, a warning.
I don't think that most people have common sense.
No, that's true. It's not very common, is it?
No.
That's the least common of senses, you know.
It is.
Yeah, true. All right. Well, anything else we want to cover before we shut this thing down this week?
I don't think so.
Okay. I think we've covered it pretty much all.
And I think we made a good dent in the feedback, actually.
We did.
We're halfway through June, so.
Yeah, so we're getting there. We're catching up.
The beginning of July, so we're fine.
Okay, good. I feel better. Thank you.
Yeah, we are doing good.
I'm just trying to put it into perspective.
Yeah, everything should be put into perspective, that's for sure. So, let's see. This week, we have the weekend. Those of us in the United States are going to be celebrating Independence Day on Saturday, and fireworks and all that kind of good stuff. And then, Rick, when do you go back out again?
I'm out on a Tuesday, I believe, on the 6th. I leave on just a short 3-day trip. It's actually not too bad. It's a 4-day trip because I have to go down to Santiago and do my yearly evacuation and emergency training. So we basically have to go down to the aircraft, the mock-up, and we don't have a 777 because, all we have up there is the slide for a 340, the slide for a 767, and then we have to jump off the slide there, you know, let the guys demonstrate to them that we still know how to do that. We have to operate the door, which we actually have to do on the 777 because we don't have a 777 mock-up door. And then we have to put out a galley fire with a fire extinguisher, and then we have to sit through a CRM class and all that stuff. So that's going to take 2 days down there. And then I fly back up, and then I'm off again. Surprise, surprise.
Great.
Yep.
Sounds like a fun trip. Yep, Stephanie, anything interesting going on next week for you?
Nope. I'm working Monday through Friday, 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. every day.
Excellent.
I got Thursday afternoon off.
Uh-huh.
I'm not on call next week, so, well, what? Actually, I take that back. I'm on call on Monday, because mm-hmm. it's part of the 4th of July. Well, my call got all messed up. I was supposed to be on call this weekend, but it got switched, so I'm on call for part of it, but not the entire weekend.
Well, we hope nobody calls you.
I hope so, too.
Leave you alone.
Yeah.
Yeah, me too. I hope you get to and just float around in that beautiful lake of yours in a little in an inner tube holding an American flag, you know.
Yeah, great. I got it. Well, we've decided we need another flag for the dock, so I'm gonna go buy one of those tomorrow, and then hopefully we'll have some friends down and just enjoy the 4th of July.
Nice.
Yeah. Excellent. And next week I'm back out on another 4-day Monday through Thursday. I'll be in Orlando, Miami, and Orlando on those days for the layover. And so sometime next week we'll hopefully record another episode of the Airline Pilot Guy. If you're interested in learning more about the show and want to know or listen to previous episodes, you can head over to airlinepilotguy.com, and there you'll find information about different ways to watch and listen to the show. And also, if you're interested in contributing to the coffee fund, information is there regarding that as well. And thank you to Arash again for all the fine work on the website. And again, thank you for all of you who have subscribed via iTunes and who have left reviews. It's always helpful as well. And until next time, wishing you clear skies, unlimited visibility, and tailwinds. Take care and God bless.
Thank you, guys. Happy birthday, America. Woohoo!
Goodbye, everyone.
Good day.